ไม่ได้เตรียมมานะครับเป็นการคุกเคลียร์แบบกระทันหันนะครับ
ประธานสภาสถาปนิกแห่งประเทศฟิลิปปินส์และอาจารย์คมสันธีรภาพวงศ์อาจารย์ประจำคณะสถาปัตยกรรมมหาวิทยาลัยเชียงใหม่ค่ะ In the afternoon sessions we will have for 5 panel discussions. The first panel for this afternoon will talk about urban design which consists of the following speakers. Ms. Jumex Amelebons, Vice President for the United Architects of Philippines and Assistant Professor Dr. Khomsan Thiraphapwong, Lecturer Faculty of Architecture University, Chiang Mai University. Please welcome.
Hope you didn't eat too much.
Yes.
And now you cannot forget.
Go up the mail. Bring back. Into like this.
Great.
Thank you. Please join me in thanking those two that I just grabbed. So Ajahn Boon has been working and actually behind some of the changes, the positive changes we've seen, but we obviously want to do more, and hopefully we can learn from the hurting now to not hurt again. And I think Chiang Mai has a lot of very smart people, but sometimes it's about moving from smart people to smart community, smart society, by working together and really create action. And I think one example of working together, co-creating a solution, we found in Khongen, and also now this is also happening in Phuket, and now Consolidated has been kindly visiting us twice this month, I think, to help initiate and plant the idea for the similar action in Chiang Mai to solve this problem. So we would like to invite Consolidated from Khongen Think Tank to share about what's going on in Khongen. Thank you, Consolidated.
Yeah, thank you, Sawadee Khap. So first of all, thank you very much, Khun Martin, that invited me to Chiang Mai. So I have some very short clip for you to see because the time is very short. So I think to see the clip for 3 minutes is better than anything.
Consists of 20 public and private organized double-track railway trains and high-speed trains. One of those trains is projected to have a northeast rail line that will go through the province of Khongen, which is a big city and serves as a hub for transportation and trade in the region. Therefore, in order to undertake this colossal project that the government will soon invest in, Khongen Think Tank Group, KKTT, has assembled the people of Khongen together. This assembly consists of 20 public and private organizations, 8 economic organizations in the province, Khongen Community for the Future Foundation, 24 Chinese organizations, and Khongen University. This project has given the organization the opportunity to improve basic infrastructures within the province in line with the huge investment plan of the government to develop the transportation system. In order to develop the basic infrastructure of the province, the assembly has put together a funding program and basing their public transportation as a leading example. The goals are to develop the basic infrastructures of the province in the form of city improvements using appropriate techniques. For the city of Khongen to grow in every direction, to be worthy of being the regional hub of ASEAN and of being the city of the future, in order to prepare for entering the ASEAN economic community. At present, the problem of distributing centralized funds within the country is that most of the funds end up in Bangkok. This makes the funds for developing the regions, especially in developing preventive measures, arrive slow and considerably low. The province of Khongen, through the Khongen Think Tank Group, KKTT have observed that despite waiting for the funds to arrive, the province has grown and developed very fast. But the delay and the low amount of government funding will become an obstacle in sustaining such growth. Therefore, it is necessary for the province to raise funds from other sources and focusing on what will benefit the province the most. The first investment needed by the Konkan think tank, KKTT, is the light electric rail transit system and developing the appropriate area for such system. This is called the transit-oriented development or commercial space development by basing public transportation as a leading example. At present, the private sectors have registered as a company limited with a total capital of 200 million baht under the name Konkan Think Tank Company Limited, KKTT. The company will begin the transit-oriented development and commercial space development as their first project. The north-south line of the light electric rail system will have a distance of 26 kilometers and a total of 18 stations. The electric train will be assembled within the country and the system will run 15 trains. Each train will have 3 cars and a capacity of 180 people per train. The project will require the use of an area from the government that will serve as a repair and develop.
Okay. You can see that, you can still see the clip from the YouTube. You can search for the KKTT. So I would like to talk about the why this project is happened. They said we have to stand here. Dr. Kun, they said we have to stand here on this cross.
No. The key
you pick. Okay, Konkan future development. So, our city, like Dr. Kun, he said, we heard many times that the government, they promised that they will give the budget to develop the city. But actually, we never got that budget. So do you think that our city is developed in the right direction or not? We think that that is not direction. So in the scope of the smart city, now, it's a lot of people, the government also want to be that Chiang Mai Smart City, Phuket Smart City. They want to point up that smart city in that province. But actually, smart city have 6 pillars. And that inside that 6 pillars, the most difficult one is the 2 pillars. Which one do you think? The first one is what we are doing, is the smart mobility. The city have to have the good transit first, so the city will have the good smart mobility. But the second one, what do you think? That is the most really difficult smart one. People. In Thailand, it's smart government. That is really difficult for us. That what we try to drive the smart government also. But to be the sustainability development, we have to care on this we call 3 bottom line: social, economics, and environment. The most important, just like the sample in Konkan, they have the law that they say if you build the building that not taller than 19 meter, you don't need to build a car park. So one big group in Thailand, they build really big building in Konkan, but not taller than 19 meter. They don't build a car park. But 500 people working in that building, where's the car to park? They park on the road. And then they obstruct the traffic because they are not just only parking in one line, they park in 4 lines, 5 lines sometimes. That is the problem for we not just able to work only on the law level. To be sustained, we have to have R&D, creativity, and innovation also. And in Konkan, we ask, what kind of people we need to be in our city? We need a lot of some bad people, or we need some creativity people. We want what is the town that we want to build to be the people that to call them to come to our city. So Konkan, in the middle, in the green, in the middle, we call Khon Kaen livable, sustainable. So how to make Khon Kaen livable and sustainable? Then we go for the second green. We have to design our city into the right way. And then we go for the round green. That means we first we do the smart mobility and we do the complexity for Khon Kaen by using the TOD, that means transit-oriented development. We do the tram by ourselves. They have the sample that the city can change by the transit. On the left side, on your left side in Strasbourg, I think most of your guys has been to Strasbourg. Many years ago, the mayor wanted to bring the tram to the Strasbourg. At that time, Strasbourg, 30 years ago, still the car society. When he bring there, and then a lot of people is complain. But after that, the life of the city is coming back. On the right side also, we went to Oregon, Portland. Same, 30 years, 20 years, they can change the city from the car society to the transit society. In Thailand, like what we say, we heard many times that the government promised that they will give the budget to develop the city. But until today, we don't get any single baht from them. Most of the money have to rescue Bangkok first. We don't blame in Bangkok because Bangkok is very important for Thailand. Bangkok like heart of Thailand. So, okay, we have money, we have to fix the heart first. But we in Khon Kaen, we want to sit and wait again? No. Then when it doesn't feel right, go left. Okay, Khon Kaen turn left now. Many years ago, we talked to the government that, okay, we have many times that we have studied, we have a lot of paper. University produce a lot of paper to study how to development for the city, but government never give the budget to the city. So we said, if you use that paper that you accept and we find our own money, can you let us do or not? So the government NCPO, not yet. So this is 20 people in Khon Kaen. 20, just like you see in the clip in Khon Kaen, they have Toyota dealer also. They have their Hino dealers. They have many people. This is the third generation in Khon Kaen. Their father, their mother said, okay, we pay the money, we invest the money and we develop the city by ourselves. So we invest 200 million baht together for 20 company here. And then after that, we are on the first stage. That we use only that 200 million baht to study, to do anything in the city, to ask the permission from the government. And this guy, I think you know him. You know him? In Thai we call Wana Khosocho. But the in Thai Wana Khosocho, I have to translate in Thai a little bit. Wana Khosocho di Khon Kaen. พวกผมเรียกว่าหัวหน้าคณะส่งเสริมนะครับนวัตกรรมแห่งชาติไม่ใช่หัวหน้าคณะส่งเสริมเรื่องอย่างนั้นนะครับก็คือ so he is the head of the I know very hard to translate in English, the time is short. Okay, so this NCPO, the government, he is the prime minister and he is the head of NCPO also. He already give the semi approved to Khon Kaen.That okay, Khon Kaen can turn left. So that what Khon Kaen do is not only the traffic to fix the traffic jam, but the Khon Kaen what Khon Kaen do is a transdisciplinary, and it like sustainable for the for the city planning, and it is the real public participation, and that is the.It's a sample for other city now Phuket are using. And yesterday we talked to Chiang Mai. Chiang Mai want to use this model also. When you do the something like this, they have a lot of people don't like you. I tell Chiang Mai already, you will find this situation. Someone blaming, someone like you and someone don't like you. This is the name of the project that we got approved from the government, from the NCPO, very long. Okay, 3 minutes.
What is this Khon Kaen model is coming from? We came from the love of your city and leadership. And then we have to untrap society. That is our duty. That is not government duty. You have to change your mind, change your way of thinking that this is our duty. So we have private and we have government. And we use that on that side is three bottom line, like a shock absorber. And this side we have smart city, like the other side of shock absorber. And the most important is this one, ego. We have to reduce the ego. And we have a lot of communication with the city, social enterprise, flexibility, and continuously, and transparency. And we build the top one is we build the infrastructure for the city, for the smart city by the tram system, transit system, plus the capital market. So at the top is a government idea, is a young yun mang kang man kong puyang ID no. It's really hard to do, it's a sustainable something like that. So now we
prosperity
and what? Sam yang kue le man kong.
Prosperity and
mang kang.
Wealthy.
Yang yun sustainable or everything, something like that. Thank you very much. So we change the habit of the Khon Kaen people first. Now we are doing smart bus for let them to make understand how the smart bus are to working. Now we have 2 free in the Khon Kaen University. In this bus you can have the application. You have application, you can load KK Transit, you can try. Then I can make advertising on the application also. So they have the application, they have Wi-Fi in the car, it's good for environment, they use NGV, and they have the application, they have the smart bus stop also. At the bus stop, you can see that when the bus will come, how many minutes, what line, something like that. And we have a lot of KPI we have social that we can reply for all when you lost and found on anything. And our team, KKTT, is went to study for the smart city in the Portland, PSU also. So we think that, it's a lot of things to go. Sorry. Okay. Key of success of our team. First of all, low profile and leadership and sacrifice. Small group, but the right ingredient. And public-private, very good participation. We have to use very good public-private participation and consistency and share ideology. We also probably on the TED Talk. On this one, I give the TED Talk on Khon Kaen. Khun Martin also there. And now it's already on the YouTube. You can see on this one, you will understand
don't why. Don't do must see.
This this one we call my
my talk
name is Next Life. You have to see why Next Life. If you don't do now, it's Next Life you cannot do. So most of all, first very important for Khon Kaen is ego. We have to reduce ego. Chiang Mai also. The most important for Thai is ego. Ego is too much for Thailand, for Thai people. Then Einstein said ego is one divided by knowledge. But the knowledge in this one, it is not your degree. The knowledge on this one of Einstein is Buddhist. That is the wisdom or something like that. I cannot understand. Someone can. At the last slide, don't forget to buy the book for Martin. I bought it already, just now. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you for the promotion. Actually, the one that we also would like to promote is you buy this polo shirt. And because this polo shirt really...
Oh, sorry, I get for free yesterday.
You got for free yesterday, right? So you had to buy the box. แต่ทำไมผมโปรโมทเสื้อนะครับเพราะว่าผมถ้าจะอ่านสโลแกนเราก็ไปถามคนรุ่นใหม่ว่าควรจะไปเขียนสโลแกนอะไรบนเสื้อตัวใหม่นะฮะนี่เพิ่งออกมาไม่กี่อาทิตย์เขาบอกว่า can do เชียงใหม่ทำได้ไม่ต้องรอใครเราทำเองได้ถ้าเราร่วมกัน so this slogan I think is quite important for Chiang Mai people and I think many people here love Chiang Mai and support Chiang Mai so I think Chiang Mai can do it and these two people here he's coming from Khon Kaen we make him work way hard three times, 3 days, 3 talks so no free lunch here so to speak in English so thank you Khun Saradee, thank you Ajahn Boon ที่มาแทงปันไอเดียวันนี้นะครับขอบคุณครับ so I think we need one more chair up here and can the next is full of you know your presentation so many is that right that's a nickname something like that so I'd like to invite Jumex to start first the Philippines so from Cebu right
is this working
okay and now it is
All right, so I'm going to talk about streetwear Southeast Asia Cebu. Streetwear is it's actually a visiting school by AA School of London. So
the streetwear conference, there were people in this network that met there, but they didn't know that another network exists. And so, and I was just talking to another professor at Chiang Mai University and said, "Is this guy from Chiang Mai University?" I said, "Yes, Ajahn Boon San is from Chiang Mai University." Great, I really need to talk to him. so, Ajahn Khom San is a Thikana Sathapat, and I have got a kayak to rule out Gyokap, Gan Patana Niman, Luba, Gyokap, Khong Gan, UNESCO, Tila, Gaman Samak, and I have got Ben Tandring, they team Gan, so you can talk to him about the UNESCO application and also about the Niman area development. We had a discussion with the Faculty of Politics the other day. The Ajahn Ora on and Ajahn Boon, เขาใช้คำว่าอะไรนะภาษาไทย we said collective failure something like that ภาษาไทยเรียกว่าอะไรนะครับ it's like everybody is making the right decision for themselves but as a community that leads to the wrong outcome so I think Niman at the moment is an example คือทำลายตัวเอง it's kind of making destroying itself right now the Niman area and I think Chiang Mai as a whole we need to reallySolve some problems, and I think cities like Cebu and others are similar, like it's time for action, and maybe small projects, pilots, but also more planning. God, ขอบคุณทั้งสองท่านอีกทีนึงนะครับ thank you so much. We're going to use the flip charts and the notes again to collect your questions, and afterwards contact them. So if you want to ask a specific question to them, either go to see them, or put it on the flip chart, and we find a way. You can also put down your email address, for example, on it. So เราจะสามารถเชื่อมโยงได้นะครับก็ฝากไว้เขียนบนกระดาษที่อยู่บนโต๊ะกลางนะครับเพราะว่าเนื่องจากเวลาสั้นก็ขอบคุณแค่นี้ก่อนนะครับขอบคุณครับครับขอโรงแรมเปลี่ยนแก้วนะครับ
อาจารย์ปุ่นเที่ยงบุญธรรมอาจารย์ภาควิชาวิศวกรรมและการบริหารการก่อสร้างคณะวิศวกรรมศาสตร์มหาวิทยาลัยเชียงใหม่และคุณสุรเดชทวีแสงสกุลไทยกรรมการผู้อำนวยการและประธานบริษัทขอนแก่นพัฒนาเมืองค่ะ Our second afternoon session is about making our city smarter and includes two speakers Assistant Professor Dr. Pun Thiang Bun Tham Director Urban Planning and Development Center Chiang Mai University andMr. Suradet Tobi Sang Sakunthai, co-founder and CEO of Khon Kaen Think Tank. Please welcome. ลำดับต่อไป
เดี๋ยวรอต่อไปนะครับรอต่อไปนะครับน่าสนใจเราก็น่าเป็นห่วงอีกนะ
โอเคค่ะสำหรับเซสชั่นต่อไปนะคะมีทั้งหมด3 guest speaker ด้วยกันนะคะท่านแรกคุณมาริสามาติเทลลี่ฟิล์มโปรดิวเซอร์นะคะท่านที่สองคุณยัสมินออสเทนดอฟเป็นผู้ก่อตั้งองค์กร Green Art Lab ค่ะแล้วก็คุณนิรันดรโพธิกานนท์หัวหน้ากลุ่มเชียงใหม่ Sunday Cycling ค่ะค่ะ Our next and final session before the coffee break is about us people in the city and our environment and the speaker is our Miss Marisa Machitelli, film producer, Miss Yasmin Ostendorf, the founder of Green Lab Art Alliance, and Mr. Nirandon Potikanon from Chiang Mai Sunday Cycling Club.
The break, I explain that in a minute, to have some connection to what you talked about. So, Ban Chen Mahat. So, this is the end of this panel, but I just asked the three to be ready to help with a small activity that I would like you to be involved in as well. Go ahead, Tami. กิจกรรม
ค่ะจะมีกิจกรรมนะคะในช่วงระหว่างนี้เดี๋ยวให้คุณมาตินอธิบายค
่ะ so basically we now have the coffee break but we chose this session before the coffee break because we think it's time for a bit of reflection about our environment and us so although we are pressed for time I think we need to make the time so what I would like you to do is to get the coffee and your cake and then be back hereWe're going to divide the room into four areas. There's a flip chart over here. There's one here. We can move the paper from there. We'll be going to these different corners and have a conversation over a coffee with you about the things that we just heard.
ค่ะก็คิดว่าตอนนี้หลังจากจบเซสชั่น2เซสชั่นในช่วงบ่ายไปทุกคนคงมีไอเดียพลุพล่านและอยากจะแชร์ริ่งกันนะคะก็รบกวนเดี๋ยวเราจะพักเป็นกาแฟเบรกแล้วก็ให้ไปหยิบกับ
represented by Daniel I And then Fundación Metrópoli, this is based in Spain. So what we do is we study cities, or what they do is go into the city and study the urban fabric of the city and try to come up with strategies and interventions. So it's actually a workshop, and the dream was to intervene in the academe because of the current situation that we have in Cebu, at least. We felt that there was a need to up our game in terms of architecture education. So that's how it all started, and it just grew bigger from there. But I'm going to go through the process of how we came up with our proposals. So Kay already mentioned about Cebu earlier, so I'm going to skip this and save me some time. this is what the Cebu landscape looks like 5 years ago. Now you're going to see more buildings. It's one of the most fastly growing cities in the Philippines, and there's a lot of businesses going in, BPOs, foreigners come in just to set up their businesses in our city. And then the green part here is a historical district of Cebu City, which is kind of left behind and from all the progress that's going in Cebu. So this is our main subject for the streetwear workshop. It's an old maritime building built in 1910, which turned to be a hotel, and then now it's just an empty shell. So we were thinking, what can we do with the old district and highlighting this building, this beautiful building that's been left to ruins? So we started out the workshop with going to the streets. Our director, Nayara, this pretty girl over here, is responsible and is the brains of the streetwear. So we went out to the streets with our 28 students who participated in the workshop and mapped everything that's going on in our old historical district. So we had parameters during the whole entire process. So I'm not going to explain everything because it's going to consume my time, but basically how the city moves or the old historical district moves and acts and how people respond to it. We studied everything from what goes on in these old buildings and the newer ones and how it interacts. And we've mapped out that there are actually 16 in the small part of the historical district. There are 16 buildings that are just being left alone. Nothing's going on there. There's a few that tourists go to here and there, but there are actually other smaller ones that they can visit. So The question was, what can we do with for this building? So the darker it is, the older the structure is. So that's the map over there. And then the orange ones are also the commercial buildings that's going on around the historical district. There are also pop-up stores in this these areas. And then this is how we interpreted the walkability of from one historical building to another. So I'm going to skip that. For the users, we've discovered that most of them just go for retail, for trading, but not much is going on for tourists or going to these buildings or historical buildings. So we've also discovered that most of the roads over here, if you can see, there's no sidewalks. It's too narrow. If there are sidewalks, you're going to risk your life. Basically, the Philippines don't get hit. That's the only rule on the road. So, and then we've also discovered that the buildings have different porosities or permeability. So the more arcades there are, the more room for people to walk around in. But the problem is there were too many pop-up stores going on. It's hard to move around. So we were thinking, what kind of interventions are we going to put here? So the darker the blue, that's more activity for people, basically. And then we also studied, if you're going to see, the green parts or the parks are just some areas. But most of it, especially on that second picture for the Maritima building, they just used it for parking. So it's a, you know, it's a waste of a good structure. And so we go to strategies. Initially, this is what's going on in Cebu City. So you can see just pockets are filled with life. And what we wanted to happen was this one. So in this diagram, we wanted people to engage in most of the historical buildings. So we were asking, what are we going to do to be able to engage the people more? So for the proposals, we were thinking about shading units, so tripod shading units. This is just how we came about with the design. So we started out with triangular structures to represent also Maritima and to represent also the movement of the people. And then it just evolved into something like this. So it can be put together. You can have landscape for it. And this is a more modern approach for us in dealing with historical structures or the historical district to give an appeal also to, well, the younger generation, and the people who were working on this project were mostly young people as well. So this is how it looked like in the proposals. Put it in spaces where people can rest, people can enjoy the historical buildings from the outside. And then we also had proposals for underused buildings, because there were buildings all over the district that were not used. So if you can see, we have proposed garden cafes. There's one building there that has trees on it already, but it's not used. We have visitor information centers and libraries. So all of this was done in 10 days, all these proposals, by the way. And then we also had shared workshops. So maybe the one who spoke earlier can help us set up a workshop there. And then commercial pop-ups as well, so that these pop-up stores from the streets can have a place to do their commerce. And then we even went into doing a layout for the buildings as well. So I'm sorry, I have 50 slides, so I'm rushing. So an example of the of a building that we've given proposal for is this one. So that's an old building, and this is the vision for one of those old buildings. So next, we are going to concentrate more on what we're going to do with the Maritima area, which is this one, this triangle one, and how it can be, how we can emphasize it. So we were thinking of making a platform, but then it might be too massive. So we tried to put voids and add landscapes and architectures. These are the concepts that we initially have, or maybe have small modules, provide access, pocket spaces. And we also put in activities, so you can walk there, or you can have shade there, or you can have a platform, and then this is what we have for the proposal. So basically, we opened up a street to make it walkable so that the Maritima building can be more visible. And then provide also places or platforms for people to enjoy the view, the sea, and then the Maritima building. So I'll skip that. And then we also did landscape. So the lines were projected so that it's easier to go from one historical building to another. So that's how we came up with the proposal for this landscaping and the development of the Maritima building and the entire space. So this is what we came up with. Hopefully, you're going to support us. And then more walkways. Going to the other side, which is the sea view. And then even proposing a modern art museum in the area. So that is it. And then finally for the building, we made a shell within a shell. Something modern within the historical site. So we maximize the use of the views. And then this is the sections for the Maritima building. So it can be usable. You can put commercial spaces in there. And these are the perspectives there. So that's how it's going to look like. Can you play that? I have a short video about on how we're going to do it. So at the end of the workshop, we were presenting it to the public officials and several agencies in the government. We're also constantly doing exhibits for what we've done in the workshop, and we are happy to announce that the National Museum of the Philippines, through the Office of the President, has actually expressed their interest in making the project come to life. So I hope you enjoy that as much as we did.
Sounds like a lot of fun. Yeah? Can we just give her a big hand of applause? Thank you, Jumax. I think this was quite a visual presentation, so we might skip the summary and type over. It was quite, a lot of pictures and so. We will move on to the next speaker. But I just wanted to say, I like this flip chart. This is great. We will look at it and evaluate today or after today. เราจะไปดู แล้วก็จะหาวิธีที่จะตอบคำถามคุณนะจะเป็นทาง internet ก็ได้ So next speaker is not so far is from the other side of town, from Chiang Mai University, Ajahn Kom San. Summarize this one in English afterwards, because
actually it's in English.
You will do it.
Yes.
Oh, cool. Great.
So I some lady to translate to. But anyway, thank you. And I think the mini yoga will help me a lot, because it's nerve-wracking, because of standing here is very nervous and in front of you guys here. And it's my honor to be part of one of the 18 speakers. What I'm trying to speak today, maybe you put me into the category of urban designer because of my background, what I educated from, both US and UK. But actually, the two projects that I'm to share with you, share my experience with you, it's more into a sort of like sort of strategic planning, and also another one is more sort of like historical heritage discovery, and then propose it to part of the Chiang Mai World Heritage for UNESCO. So I saw many people that I see that we can learn from Georgetown, and also some people that I work with a small community, which is the first one that I want to tell you about that, which is the small community that I be part of it because of, I live in the area. This area is called Niman Hemin in Chiang Mai, and the area actually, if you know a lot about Chiang Mai, you will learn that it's become, so to speak, a hip area, which is there's a lot of coffee place, a lot of night eating restaurants, something like that to hang out. So the area, for any one of you who are not familiar with Chiang Mai, you can see this old historic town, which I will talk to you later. We got Ping River, and then we got a very big belt, I would call the, it's a superhighway. And then when it's constructed in the early 1970s, it just stopped here at this junction, which is called Rincon intersection. I don't know why, but it's supposed to be completed toward the airport. And then this little tiny street becomes the street that we nowadays become a trendy place called Niman Hemin. And this is the commercial map that we always use it because of the map that you can find about the eating place, the nice coffee place. As you can see, this is the intersection that I told you, Rincon intersection, and then this is a big superhighway. Just stop here, and then this is the main street for Niman Hemin. Basically, in my class that I teach in Faculty of Architecture, we always have students to in urban design subject to do some survey around here. We actually divide it into part, the top, the upper part, and then the lower part. In between the two, there will be a little tiny street. It's called Chiang Rai Song, as I remember well, connected to CMU. CMU is the main university here. So that means little tiny street we call Soi. In the past, when Chiang Mai University has been constructed, it's actually a house for those professors, teacher, lecturers, and maybe some people who want to live in a good community. So in a way, it used to be a residential zone before. And you can see these two pictures around at the moment that the problem is, actually it's not a problem, but it's become a movement of the area that the house sometimes has been sold or has been rented by the business people. So they convert the house into a very nice shopping area, nice coffee place, or it's commercial. And that's gonna be the big problem within the community. Why? Because of there's an influx of a different kind of, I would say, the mascots who want to sell their business, and like this one, and also some nice little craft and then designer, which is actually good in a way because of sometimes it becomes studio for designers, sometimes becomes sort of like a front shop for those design stuff. But the problem is the more commercial has been, as I told you, in flag around. So that's been the residential zone, which used to be before, has become characteristically changed into a mixed use zone. So we got a lot of problems in a way. This is this picture showing the problem that we have a lot of congestions, the motorcycle, sort of like the vendor shops that's parking along the road selling their products, a lot of problem with the water flooding, and we have a great famous that you can see online, all the electric wires all around. So these are actually the basic for the urban designer to look around and then try to find out the problematic within the zone. And what we did within the community, you have to imagine that as part of me, I look at in a point of view as a resident people. So all the residents who used to live before, they gathering together and then try to think about how we're going to deal with those problems that I told you. We actually have a collaboration with the CMU. At that time, we have they call it CSR, Corporate Social Responsibility. So they have a program that work together with the community and the CMU people to come and then do some small research about that, and I was part of it. And we divide into a three big problem in the three different scales. That's in time mixed with English. The first one, I'll summarize you a little bit. We divide in the first scale, which is soil scale. You can see this is a small soil. We have a lot of problems about the infrastructure, about the traffic, because of why? Because of when you have a house, basically you've got a parking lot, and then on the side of the small soil, you can park the cars. But when things change, a lot of houses have been sold, then the chop house has been constructed. So when you see the shop house, then each shop house has its own entrance, so you can't park the car anymore. So that's why we have a lot of congested parking when they come to lunch, when they come for hangout at evening time. So that's a basically main of the problem of the soil. And the second scale, which is the area scale, in a way, if you look through the area, it is connected to the main superhighway, which just got stuck here. Imagine that, 8 lanes of the superhighway come through here, and then we got combined to 2 lanes, or at least sometimes 4 lanes, plus the parking of those mobile shops and restaurants. So it's going to be a big, huge stuck here. And no matter how hard that the policemen try to change or solve the problem, we always have a problem all the time during the rush hour, in the morning and in the evening time. And also this area, it's like a, sort of like a basin, which is sort of a node for the CMU. If you imagine that for the big scale, if you know that CMU is around on the left side, which is on the west side of town, and then far side is a Suthep Mountain. So the only way that those, like 10,000 people or staff of CMU just going, they're going this way from west to east. So Nimah Himin is like a sort of like a basin area, which we have to sort of like deal with those problems with the influx of the cars. And the last one is a scale in terms of the city. If you think about the bigger scale, the city of this part, actually one part of my research is just telling that they actually pulled the string of the old town. I will tell you later about the old town. Why? Because of the before, Chiang Mai City, which is square shape, they used to have a very nice organization of the planning. But when Lee Man Hemin start, or CMU start, they tend to spend time most of the day and then the night time within this area. So that means the old city has been segregated. I did some research about the fragmented Chiang Mai City. So in a way, Chiang Mai City has been fragmented. So that's mean the old historic town is no longer significant anymore. So in a way, we have a problem. So this is a photograph showing that community that we have a meeting before. We have a meeting once a month, and then we're dealing with some special stuff with the policemen, traffic policemen. The policemen try to change the one way or two way traffic, and then they try to make it like that. You can see this is the first try, and then the second try they make the whole things like one way through the site, which is Sri Mangkarajan Road. So we actually take action to that. Imagine that this is nothing to do with the municipality, with the governmental people anymore. We're just dealing with our own sake. Imagine that if you own the condominium in a high-rise building, usually they have a management team for the condominium. So we are the management team, like the whole condominium within the area. Yes, okay. And we've got another one too. Okay, I'm gonna speed up. This is what we deal with the CMU. We did some sort of like we call it a marathon. We asked the people and then the students from CMU to sort of like collecting a good old house in the area. I'll put it quick. And then we did some sort of like throw out a lot of good pictures that we like to deal with sort of urban design, the foot pathway, how we're going to deal with the green. Okay, and the reason is why I link with this because of the imagine that this is about 50 years old neighbor. And imagine that in Chiang Mai, we have almost about 720 years old neighbor. Along within the square share, we have about 13 or 14 neighbor. And during the King Meng Rite, starting about 720 years ago, up to King Gavila, which is about exactly 500 years, King Gavila tried to do some mecca. I think maybe made it the first mecca urban renewal, about 220 years ago. So within the area, we have about 14 up to 15 community, and this is the reason that I'm trying to link with this project that I'm doing at the moment, because it's on process. It's about the fact that we try to use sort of like a framework of the UNESCO World Heritage as part of improving our heritage within the old core zone and historic zone as part of it. This is just the main focus that we're going to do. And this is, of course, there are about 10 criteria. Of course, the first six will be all those historical stuff. This is just a study that we did a little bit about. I told you before, Niman's around here. And you can see this is this old square shape with a little more like a crescent here. And we tried to mapping what significance in a way, because I think Penang and Georgetown people knows about that. When we're doing OUV, you need to risk up all the good things that we have, and then try to identify what kind of OUV that. We did also the axis line, and also the connection to the old VM, which is Wing Jet Lin around here, Wing Sun Do around here, and also connected to Wat Phat Dosu Thep as well. I'm going to do it quickly. This is what we actually come up at the moment. We just finished the first phase about the writing the first three chapters of the dossier. The first that we deal, I'm going to go for that. Yeah, this is the three area that we decide to be part of the submission in the dossier. We have like of course the main Vieng Chiang Mai, Vieng Sun Do, and then also the Wat Phat Dosu Thep, which is linked with their access sort of vista view to the top of the mountain, but also they also have some intangible and symbolic into the city as well as a whole. And what we do next, which is actually going to be my part, we're going to do some design because of the, if you know that UNESCO, we're going to come with their management plan as well. So what we do for the next year or 2 years, we're going to do sort of like a scenario, and we're going to do some sort of like community participation, and then list up the program from the community, and then try to find out about the layer of different kind of significant or the sort of like a primary project that we're going to do. And then some of them, it's going to be a conservation, some of them are going to be a renovation, some of them are going to be a lot of sort of like, just leave it like that. So what we have to do next is to create those sort of projects, and then list up everything that we're going to do for the management plan. And then the problem is this is the last slide, is the fact that part of it is just a strategy that we actually don't. I mean, some of you might know that, I mean, to be listed on the World Heritage site may be good or bad, but what we really actually want to achieve is to set up some sort of like a very serious conservation plan, also maybe development plan, or even creative plan based on the heritage and the framework of the UNESCO as part of the development of the whole area of the Chiang Mai municipality, which is there are actually 1, 2, 3, 4 of them, which is in the area of the historic site. And hopefully that sooner or later, this city, which is you actually here, is going to be part of the very, very sort of a nice in terms of the old past and then the new that come together. That's it. Thank you so much, indeed.
Thank you. เสร็จที่นั่นเมื่อคืนเราไปทานข้าวเย็นด้วยกันนะครับแล้วก็มีหลายๆท่านมาจอยเพื่อมาดูว่าจะทำที่เหมือนที่คอนแกน If you don't know about Khon Kaen now is a real cool city that Chiang Mai can learn from. We always think Chiang Mai maybe is second biggest and important city or whatever, but I can tell you I was just in Khon Kaen a few weeks or so for his TED talk and other TED talks. And Khon Kaen is really interesting what's going on, and Consolidate is one of them. And Atan Bun from Chiang Mai University is a person who's been standing up for the city development for many times, and he's still doing it. And I think hopefully this time we see more progress, because it's been quite hard for you. So you can tell us a little bit about the challenges and what we can do next. 10 minutes, okay for you?
It's okay.
Signity, okay? Chiang Kao, Atan Bun.
So in the English?
Can you? Okay.
I'm sorry for the slide in Thai, but I translate in English. So I think this session for 10 minutes of my speaking, I think that all of us has been know a while about the Chiang Mai situation. Mm-hmm. Anyone from Chiang Mai, please raise hand up. Okay. And anyone that might be not in the Chiang Mai, but I would like to ask from my heart, who love Chiang Mai? Thank you. Mm-hmm. I think that the reason that we try to say now is not just technical problems, or it's not just the idea that we want to go. But the thing that challenges us right now is how we are going to achieve the thing that we looking for the Chiang Mai. I will say one thing, not everything. The one thing that Chiang Mai have problem is the transportation. Mm-hmm. 96% or 92% around this one is based on the private vehicle. Mm-hmm. In the past, we have bus. Maybe some of these guys might be quite know about the red, the yellow bus, but right now all of the fixed transit have been collapsed. Mm-hmm. Not because of they don't want to run it, but because of the policy haven't balanced. Mm-hmm. So most of the private public cars, public transit has been cannot fight with the private car. So the thing that we try to do hard is to reinitialize the private car, no, reinitialize the public cars come back again. Mm-hmm. So we call this kind of not just presenting, I call this kind is the action. We will learn more about the content, what content can do. So this presentation will reflect as the people that still hard in the Chiang Mai, what we can do. Mm-hmm. We call the plan. Mm-hmm. We have to plan the first. Many times we plan, we fail, right? Mm-hmm. But failure doesn't mean we stop. Mm-hmm. We will forgive, but we will not forget. So the plan of the Chiang Mai. So the thing that we will fight on is not we not want to fight with the red cap. The thing that we fight with the private car. So our vision, I think, all of academy have been already told us that we need a mass transit. We need a public transit. Mm-hmm. But the reality has been not lightly with them. So we call upon the action. Why? Because Chiang Mai, from the sky view, a lot of the problem have been beneath the carpet. If you know Thai guys, anything that most of us tell you about the, you can do it. That's probably that mean you cannot do it. Sometimes they tell you that you cannot do it. That mean you can do it. I might say that is Thai style or not in the Korean like Gangnam style, but it's Thai style. So it's very difficult for me myself also to interpret what Thai guys say. Mm-hmm. But the thing that we know that is not just like a typical message. Mm-hmm. Konkan have their own culture. Phuket have their own culture. The last night we discussed Chiang Mai, we have our own culture. But it's like a taboo for us to tell what we are. Mm-hmm. So that is, in the Thai, we call Mueang Prap Sien. What it should be said? Prap Sien. It's like, if you are expert from the other area, if you come to Chiang Mai, please be careful. Mm-hmm. It's high risk from the outsider. Even though you say it's really smiley, everything easy, but when we do the business, when we do the real thing, it's not quite easy. So it's like a dialogue that we have been discussed for quite a decade. Mm-hmm. Well, what happened? Why still this infrastructure that we pay the tax and still like this? Because four things, sorry for the language. The first one for the blue one, mm-hmm. The operator, the traffic operators haven't secured mm-hmm. the job. The red cap already hunting down for the customer. They're not just like a stable occupation, but it's like they still, their feeling is like a hunt for the customer, not service for the customer, hunt down for the customer every day. So this feeling of the public transit mm-hmm, in the Chiang Mai nowadays. So this is the first problem. Why? Because they don't have financial investment. It's very difficult for the real estate. We can call upon the loan from the bank. But if you are transport operator, it's very difficult mm-hmm, to get the loan from the bank. So the situation of the finance of this sector seems to be very, very limited. From the red one, we don't have a horse. Everyone do it. Mm-hmm. Not just Thailand, not just Chiang Mai, but Khon Kaen and Phuket also doesn't like the developed society. They have also everyone. If we would like to complain about traffic jam, we would like to complain it. No one can point out, mm-hmm. even though we pay the tax. Mm-hmm. And then for the traveler, only choice that they have is mm-hmm. not just walk. Mm-hmm. The only choice that they have is the only private car. If you have a high income, more than 1500, most probability that you could be select the car. But if you lower than that, you select the motorcycle. So it's the best option that for the customer happy. For the all of the four pillars that we have a programs. That's a picture that I did 5 years ago, try to lay out. We still have existing the transportation in Chiang Mai. Mm-hmm. But you guys know that? No. Mm-hmm. We still have it, but it's run based on the ad hoc process. Mm-hmm. So what we should do? Now, the pillar that we should do is not just the romantic idea. But right now that I try to call on, Dr. Suradev try to call on for the Khon Kaen, we ask for the volunteer. Not just that you haven't been born in the Chiang Mai. I can call you the Chiang Mai guys because you already fall in love with this country, with this city already. So I call you Chiang Mai people. So we not just need the state to run for us. But now the changing, we need us to run the operation, not just begging them to pay the infrastructure for us. You pay the tax? Yeah, you pay the tax. So you have the right to ask for the public service. The Thai guys, the visitor in the Chiang Mai need to have it. That's the basic infrastructure. Why? Mm-hmm. So now, we have to come together as a group of the private sector, of the state, of the academia, and of the local people together. So we try to bring it up mm-hmm. as a corporate, as a social enterprise. But now we're not alone. We have a Khon Kaen move forward. We have Phuket move forward. This year is different from the 5 years ago that I discussed with Khun Martin. Mm-hmm. But this year, it's time for us to join together, not just Chiang Mai, but the smart city. Smart city doesn't mean smart infrastructure, but it means smart people. My dad told me what it means smart people. It means if you have your finger and put on the power cord, is it hurt? Mm-hmm. And you put it on it and hurt again, we call it stupid. Smart people, we call that. If you put down your finger in the power cord and it hurt, and next time you remember, now Chiang Mai, you are, I think as you heard, you feel not comfortable with the public transit. Mm-hmm. But we still believe that is normal. I don't think it's smart people, right? Mm-hmm. So what we are going to do, we do 5 things. City Hall. What means City Hub? I will tell you later. We run out of the time. We mean smart school bus. I will tell you later. That means smart school bus. We need smart bus. We know that what is transit line going to be. Mm-hmm. And we know about the TOD. I think Dr. Suradev will tell you more about what we should do about the urban planning. Mm-hmm. I'm so glad that I met you guys allow this meeting because some of us have been worked in a similar problem, so we can join together. And we need more sustainable mass transport system. The thing that we do today is not just me, myself, it's not just us for today. The thing that we do today is because we love Chiang Mai and we think about the city for the next generation. We see the city about to fall down. That is a call upon the action. So we're looking for hundred plus giver by Chiang Mai for the Chiang Mai. Thank you.
ขอบคุณครับ invite Marisa to talk about something which we should think about all the time but I think we it's aboutcoming soon again this season, right?
For most of you who are visiting Chiang Mai for the first time, it might be difficult to imagine this is how Chiang Mai looks pretty much routinely every year now, every March. It's now called smoky season. It's not really a season, it's completely man-made. It's a problem that we've seen all over Southeast Asia. It's not a problem that's unique to Thailand. I'm sure many places that you come from, Vietnam, Malaysia, Indonesia, you have similar problems as well. But what I've noticed from studying this problem is that in different countries there are different sources of the problem. This problem is a relatively new problem in Chiang Mai. I've been living here for 7 years now, and my family's been living here for about 15 years. So during that time I've been traveling here a lot. And I noticed 15 years ago there was no smoky season. But about 7-8 years ago it became this distinctive thing that we expect every year. And every year we see, you know, this is the view from my house. This is just, it becomes kind of routine, and then people kind of plan for it to leave the city, and I really started to become interested in it. This is all taken this year in March. When I started to feel the health effects myself, which was in March of last year, I felt like I had this tightness in my chest, and I felt like I couldn't breathe. And the information that I was seeing in the media wasn't really conveying very clearly to me what, you know, how bad the health effects really are. This is outside of the smoky season, what we think of as the smoky season. This is in May, and this is me going a little bit outside of Chiang Mai to Chengdu. So I'm a filmmaker and a photographer, I'm a storyteller. When I started to look into this problem, I started to meet scientists and meet all these different people who were trying to either explain to the public, like doctors explaining how bad it really is on your health, what the issues are. Scientists who are working on solutions. I was interviewing farmers out in Chengdu and just collecting footage. Like, I don't even know what I was planning on doing with it, but I started this in April of 2015, and then I continued until December of last year, and then I just put together a short video, like 25-minute documentary that I presented at Chiang Mai University, because many of the people that I went to look at their research were from Chiang Mai University, and then I presented it, and then it kind of started to bring more of a dialogue about the smoke issue before the smoky season, which is what I wanted. I wanted to raise awareness. This is from the World Health Organization. More than 80% of people living in urban areas where air pollution is monitored are exposed to air quality levels that exceed World Health Organization limits, according to the latest urban air quality data released by the agency. And actually, even today, even though it looks like a clear blue day in Chiang Mai, I checked the air quality, and it's at hazardous levels. Part of it, definitely in urban areas, is definitely from car pollution, which I know is going to be the next topic of conversation. But a large part of it in northern Thailand is from agricultural burning, which is what is in the background of this image, like not knowing what to do with agricultural residue, and it leads to this. The burning starts now, it continues until March, and then we're in this giant cloud of smoke. And then another interesting statistic, outdoor air pollution causes 3.7 million deaths a year, more than malaria, HIV, AIDS, and is now the biggest single killer in the world. And if you look at outdoor air pollution and indoor air pollution, that figure is about 7 million people that die per year. So I didn't really understand why, in my consciousness, I feel like air quality isn't really discussed that much. So here are several of the people that I interviewed. A lot of these people have become my mentors, and I'd like to just show you the first 3 minutes of the film, and if you'd like, it's online if anyone wants to see more of it later.
Burning season is terrible to the health of everyone it touches.
The levels of smoke and air pollution are at the point that anybody who is susceptible, like sick people, children, elderly people, they have problems.
You can't see the countryside. The countryside's dry and horrible.
เมื่อเทียบกับมลพิษน้ำ มลพิษดิน หรือว่ามลพิษสารเคมีอาหารอะไรอย่างอื่นเนี่ยเขายังเลือกได้แต่ว่ามลพิษทางอากาศเนี่ยเป็น the worst environmental pollution ที่เราเลือกไม่ได้เราต้องหายใจ
สิ่งที่น่ากลัวก็คือหมอกควันฝุ่นจากหมอกควันที่เกิดขึ้นนี่มันไม่ใช่เป็นเรื่องเล่นๆเพราะมันเล็กมากนะครับแล้วมันฝังอยู่ในปอดเลย
ผลกระทบของฝุ่นละอองเนี่ยมันกระทบต่อทุกคนความเสี่ยงในการเป็นโรคหัวใจจากฝุ่นละอองเนี่ยมันไม่ได้เพิ่มขึ้นเป็น5เท่า10เท่าอาจจะเพิ่มแค่เท่ากว่าไม่ถึง2เท่าดีด้วยนะครับแต่ปัญหาคือถ้าเรามองประชากรเป็นล้านคนเนี่ยให้เพิ่มขึ้นเท่ากว่าแต่ทุกคนเลยครับโดนเนี่ยไม่ใช่แค่10% ของประชากรที่โดนหรือ 5% ของประชากรที่โดนนะฮะเหมือนบ้านบางคนสูบบุหรี่บางคนไม่สูบใช่ไหมฮะอันนี้มันไม่ใช่คือนี่คือทุกคนสูบบุหรี่หมดนะครับดังนั้นแล้ววันหนึ่งหลายมวลด้วย
449,000 คนคือตัวเลขของชาวเชียงใหม่ที่ได้รับผลกระทบทางสุขภาพจากมลพิษทางอากาศระหว่างเดือนกุมภาพันธ์ถึงเมษายนปีที่ผ่านมา
เรื่องหมอกควันเนี่ยนะครับก็มีผลกระทบต่อคนไข้ที่พื้นที่ในเชียงใหม่เยอะมากพอสมควรครับอย่างปีก่อนเนี่ยก็มีจำนวนคนไข้ที่เป็นโรคปอดเรื้อรังนะครับเช่นโรคถุงลมโป่งพองเนี่ยนะครับก็มีอาการกำเริบมากขึ้นนะครับอย่างน้อยก็คือ 30-40%
Okay, so yeah, that last point was 30-40% increase in hospital visits in Chiang Mai during the period when it really peaks andYou can look online. This is from the World Health Organization. It tells you that it causes respiratory, cardiovascular disease in the susceptible groups. But if I could leave you with one thing today, it's that we all need to understand how air quality is measured and what particulates are in the air. So PM stands for particulates. It's how we measure the size of the fine dust in the air, and it's what we're inhaling. It's what's created from the burning of the smoke, and it's also what's in the exhaust from car fumes. So here we have like a strand of hair. The most common measurements of PM are in increments of PM10 and PM2.5. So PM10, there are these larger blue dots right here. So you can see that for one strand of hair, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5,dust. So you can't even see it. It's so, so small. But the really dangerous particles are the PM2.5, the very small red ones that are like one is, you know, a quarter the size. And those are the ones that are passing through our lungs and into our bloodstream and causing all kinds of cardiovascular problems. So the air quality guidelines as set by the World Health Organization give like the standard. If there's more than, you know, a certain amount of PM2.5 or PM10 in the air, then it becomes hazardous to your health. So their standards are here. I'll just show you the next slide to show what Thailand standards are so they can be compared. So for example, for PM2.5, 25 micrograms per cubic meter. Is the average, is the mean that's acceptable for the health standard, right? And in Thailand, if you look at PM2.5 and the 24-hour mean, it's 50. So there, I hope you can see where the problem is. It starts to affect your health when the PM level is higher than 25, but in according to the Thai standard, it's not considered a problem or a public health risk until it passes 50. And I've met the head of the pollution control department and asked him why, and he couldn't give me an answer. I said the World Health Organization standard is based on health. What is the Thai one based on? Nothing. Not wanting to disrupt tourism, you know, so, and that's actually what he said. And this is a problem all over the region. There are all these invented standards in Malaysia. Myanmar recently adapted to the World Health Organization standard. So let's look at the app, the Air for Thai app. You can download this for free. And then here it'll give you like a reading. It'll give you whether or not the air is okay quality based on their standard, which doesn't match the World Health Organization standard. This, you won't know this unless you know how to read the PM10 data. So I'm just gonna fast forward a bit through this app and then show this other app. This is through an organization called AQICN.org. They draw data from multiple sources from 80 different countries. So in most of your countries, you'll be able to use this app, and they'll interpret the same data that the Pollution Control Department gives, but then use it in an international standard. So here we can compare, same day, same time. Here's the Thai app, and here's the, you know, AQI app. It's different. So If you don't want to understand all the math behind it, I highly recommend that you download this app and then you can monitor the air quality in your area. And then also it's very important to know how to protect yourself. Staying indoors, I mean, it all sounds very apocalyptic, but really it's very important that you wear the right kind of mask, an N95 mask. And then I'll just finish off with one-minute video.
รักลูกรักหลานไหมคะรักคุณพ่อคุณแม่ปู่ย่าตายายไหมคะรักตัวเองหรือเปล่าในภาคเหนือมีโรคปอดเยอะที่สุดในประเทศไทยอย่าเป็นสถิติพวกนี้ใช้ไม่ได้ใส่หน้ากากที่ถูกต้อง
So the full documentary is on the website if anyone wants to see it. So the documentary is also written in the program. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. You might wonder why we invited Marisa to talk about this problem in a creative city, co-create and design your city. But I think it's really an important foundation for the city to have a healthy environment, and it's not an issue that's out there in the countryside, and us in the city are not affected. We are badly affected, and also we need to be part of the solution, working with the people in the farming sector. There's a lot going on in the farming sector. And we also thought it's really quite good time with this conference. I hear quite often, oh, it's not as bad as it is, as some people say, or it's got better. By government or business people, they say it's going to get better. I still remain to be convinced on how much better it's going to be come March. I know that there are many activities going on to work on the solution, but have we really made big change? I will wait for March to see. So we felt this is a very important topic to connect a little bit to the previous speakers, because some of the pollution comes from urban traffic, but a lot also comes from us not really looking after our environment and working as part of the system. So thank you very much, Marisa, for coming today. And if anybody of you, ถ้าคุณมีกลุ่มที่จะไปอยากจะไปฟังเพิ่มเติมคุณมาริสาก็ยินดีที่จะเข้าไปหาที่ถ้าเป็นมหาวิทยาลัยหรือเป็นกลุ่มอะไรก็ present เพิ่มเติมได้นะครับ so she's very I'm happy to present in different forums about this issue. And today we asked her to focus on one aspect, but she also has ideas about how to solve it and so forth. So thanks again. So I'd like to invite our next panelist, Jasmine, to talk about environment and creativity. So that sounds really...
Is this on? Yeah. Great. Saladika. My name's Jasmine. I run a network of 35 creative organizations, cultural organizations, that work with environmental issues such as air pollution. Let's see an image here. Hello.
Joy Conway.
But I also work with issues around energy transition, for instance, around ecocide, around the notion of the Anthropocene. So we work actually on four kind of different levels. One is the artistic one, so that's really the artist working with these types of issues. We work on a practical level, so we have we give workshops to cultural organizations about reducing your own environmental impact. So that means looking at your own carbon footprint, energy, water, waste, mobility, for instance, so that you don't only talk the talk, but that you can also walk the walk. We work on a level of community engagement, and then we work on an advocacy level, so working with policymakers on this issue. It's a network that's active in Europe and Asia. We have 15 partners in Asia and 20 in Europe. These are just some examples of the types of activities that we're doing. So these workshops, material innovation labs, we have a resource bank, we run a platform where you can find like grants that are available, residencies that are available, scholarships that are available on these types of topics. So that's just our Facebook page where you can find all that type of information. This is just an overview of our partners in Europe, very mixed group, and then our partners in Asia. We actually have an event next Wednesday in Bangkok with two of our Thai partners, BACC, Bangkok Art and Culture Center, and Big Trees program called Art for the Earth, where we will have a round table, share some delicious Thai food, but then also try to unravel kind of the complexities of how that food came to the table. So that will be also about packaging, about the plummeted price of rice, etc. So you're all very welcome to join that on Wednesday in Bangkok. The reason why we're all doing it is because of this. IPCC report is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. You might have heard something about rising temperatures. It might not seem a lot, a 2 degrees rise of temperature, but if you just imagine if you're ill, if you have a fever, your body only, if you have a rise of 2 degrees, you already feel very, very ill. We have no idea of how this is going to impact our crops, our biodiversity, etc. So what I gave as available budget, $6 trillion, that's what's currently invested in the fossil fuel industries that could open up. Actually, I'm just going to do something different. I just got a question during lunch, someone saying, yeah, but what have the arts got to do with climate change or with the environment? And I mean, there's a long answer to that question, but there's also a very short answer to that question. And it's one word, actually. It's a word, responsibility. And that's actually composed of two words, the word response and the word ability. Because this is what the creative sector can do. We have an ability to respond to the problem. We have the ability to come up with solutions. We have the ability to reinvent our systems. So I really quickly wanted to give a few examples of projects that we celebrate, that we work with, and that we support. Two from Southeast Asia, two from Europe, or three. These are two artists from Indonesia, Irwan and Tita, doing amazing urban interventions. This is a trash ball, a ball that's been kind of going around Jakarta for a year, collecting all the trash and becoming a kind of snowball that's been growing and everyone playing with it. This is public furniture. They work with carpenters, creating kind of spaces in the city where people can actually enjoy, kind of reclaiming public space, basically. This is from residency in Italy called Polinaria. They were tortured by a really big storm that ruined a lot of their barns and kind of buildings. They worked with a collective called Future Farmers to use all that wood to make it into a treehouse. The treehouse is now a meeting place for local farmers to exchange ancient seeds, so non-GMO seeds. And they come together, the farmers, and it's kind of a social place. Projects called Seeds of Straw. Another example, a few of you might already know him, Francis Solano from Cebu, also partner in our network. He calls himself a trash and designer, which I think is a great way of explaining it. He is a fashion designer, but he works with trash as his main material. And actually, trash doesn't need to look trashy or look like trash. These are from PET bottles. An example from actually my home country, the Netherlands, is Fairphone. Often when we speak about technology, That's actually the part where it becomes very polluting and very complicated. Fairphone is the first fair trade phone. So it is a smartphone, but it actually sources its material from conflict-free areas. It's modular, you can replace every bit of it. So that's, yeah, it can all, you can also apply this vision into the kind of designing technology. This is where designers work together on these issues. And actually, it's interesting, on their website, you can kind of look all down the supply chain. You can get the salaries from everybody working on it. It's a completely kind of fair product. Oh yeah, and it's designed to repair. The guy who invented this, he said, if you can't open it, you don't own it. We don't know how to fix our appliances anymore. So this is also part of the kind of circular economy thinking. Last example, also from Thailand. The guy running this scrap lab will also be at our event on Wednesday. Again, working creatively, in this case with waste from the manufacturing industries. There's a huge amount of waste for every product that we make. There's a really big part of it we cannot use. And he works with how to use that creatively. So working with cutoffs, refuse, sawdust, leftover, and using that into, well, it's amazing products. It's from bags to lots of other different things. My time is up. So if you want to know more about Scrap Lab, you're very welcome to join us on Wednesday in Bangkok. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jasmine. You're a box of ideas and for instance ออกแบบหรือศิลปินนะครับกับสิ่งแวดล้อมว่าจะมาเชื่อมโยงยังไงเขาก็โดนคำถามช่วงลันช์นะครับเขาบอกว่ามันเป็นเรื่องของ response ability คือศิลปินก็สามารถที่จะทำอะไรได้บางอย่างเพื่อที่จะให้เป็น inspiration กับคนทั่วไปว่าไอ้สิ่งแวดล้อมมันตอนนี้มันสำคัญแล้วก็มันจะแย่แล้วก็เป็นแล้วก็นักออกแบบเช่นกันที่ออกมือถือให้มันเป็นซ่อมได้ตอนนี้รัฐบาลสวีเดนก็มีการลดภาษีเพื่อคนที่ไปซ่อมของเช่นจะซื้อใหม่อะไรอย่างเงี้ยตอนนี้ thinking is changing to recycle to repair the Swedish government has a program to incentivize Swedish people not to buy a new TV but to get it fixed to get the fridge fixed they give a lot theyReduce your tax if you get it fixed. So a lot of changing is happening. So our next speaker for this session about us and the environment is Kuniradon from the Chiang Mai Cycling Club. Kuniradon, thank you.
Swadhi kap, good afternoon. This morning I was very glad to see about 5-6 people coming to the today's workshop.On bicycle. I came also on bicycle from home, about 7 kilometers from here. I would like to confirm the problem that Dr. Poon said that Chiang Mai has a problem of transport. I agree with him, the same problem with transport. And because of problem of transport, then we have problem of traffic jams. Well, the traffic jam in Chiang Mai, I would like to shorten that Chiang Mai changed many things and changed two-way traffic into one-way traffic on many roads, especially around the city mode. And from there, it forced many other roads to operate in two-way traffic.In one-way traffic from the older one, two-way. This is a scene along the road passing by four schools along Jalan Pathet Road. They have usually every day traffic jam, a very, very slow traffic jam. Also, a scene in front of the Tha Phae Gate.The well-known square of Chiang Mai. And because of traffic jam or the transport problem, we have done many things long time ago, so that in Chiang Mai, on 13 roads under this name, 13 roads, we had bike lanes. But the problem of bike lane was that our car can park on bike lane and nobody take action against it. It is illegal parking, but no, our police traffic don't think about that. They just said, please, you perform your task that people use a lot of bicycle and then we will control the parking. This is one of the example on the road in front of the Suan Dok or Mahalat Hospital. You see, the traffic sign is only for bicycle, but parked by car. So it is dangerous for people to use bicycle to overtake the parking car and will be hit by other vehicle coming from behind. Okay, that is on the road in front of the hospital and other road on the other side of the river. They have problem because they have bike lane on the pedestrian, but they were occupied by many stands, business stands. So to promote cycling under our problem, under our circumstances, we need to stop making bike lane along the road, on two-way road especially. Then we prefer one-way traffic roads, which allow parking on the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side or on the other side, where it is not allowed for parking, we prefer this road to have a contraflow bike lane on the other side, so that only bicycle come contraflow, and when we go along the contraflow, we keep left, and we return on the right hand, which is not parked any for 24 hours. So we will go over to see these pictures. This picture show you like an example of Loy Krok Road. People in Chiang Mai, who live in Chiang Mai, know Loy Krok Road. It is one of the roads going from the city mode into Tu Chang Klan Road. It has the traffic like this. So the car park on the left, bicycle go along the road, but upon return, we need a bike lane for contraflow to return. So this is very convenient for people who live along the road to come back not very far. If it is only one way, they have to go around the city to return home. So this is the picture from what we think it should be. And by working with many organizations, so we, here is another site. On the forbidden side to enter this road, there should be a sign to forbid entering this road except bicycle. And on the left, it is the bike lane for contraflow cycling. And then after preparation on the 18th of March 2009, the police of Chiang Mai declare 5 roads to form 3 bicycle routes of Chiang Mai as a strategic bicycle road, bicycle route. And we opened that all of this on April 6th, 2009. So, five brought together to form three bicycle routes with bike lanes. Loy Krao Road, Rachaman Khao Road, Chang Moy Road, Rachawithi Road inside the city mode. Jalan Prathet Road passing by four schools. This is the map. This is the Loy Krao Road. From here to the city mode, and then it continues through the city mode. And on this section, we use bicycle road. Actually, the bicycle, bike route on Chiang Mai Road continue into this, and this part was not done. Then we have another, bicycle road along Jalan Prathet Road through many schools here. Scene of the opening ceremony of bicycle routes. So behind this lady was the mayor of Chiang Mai, who supported our idea. And then we start together to open. So this is part of the Rachaman Khao Road, which we use it as a bicycle road. This bicycle route forming three bicycle using five road forming three bicycle road, it is now gone because the traffic police changed the direction of the contraflow for cycling to go along the road in the same direction as other vehicle, which I had a feeling that it is more dangerous. We should ride on the road by keeping left, not using the bike lane in the same direction as other vehicle, because the fastest cars overtaking another cars, they are very close to the cyclists, so it is dangerous. Then nowadays, in city mode, there are many bicycle infrastructure, which is called bicycle road, but there should be no bike lane on bicycle road. Now they are used as a parking, which is incorrect, and people who have seen this will have the feeling of unsafe to ride bicycle there. So I think I showed these pictures inside the city mode with the sign of bicycle roads. But there are parking of a car illegally along the road here also. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
And Creative Chiang Mai is a partner, and this event is part of the Chiang Mai Design Week. And TCDC is about to go big step for TCDC to move to a new office and change the whole area around that office in Bangkok. But we hope that we can also do something similar maybe in Chiang Mai with some areas in Chiang Mai. So we wanted to understand how to work with the community and also how to work with policymakers to make that happen. ก็เลยขอเชิญอาจารย์เพียรดอนกับคุณมอนเทนีจากที่ปรึกษา TCDC แล้วก็ซีเนียร์ไดเรคเตอร์ที่ TCDC มาแบ่งปันประสบการณ์วันนี้นะครับเชิญครับอาจารย
์ครับขอบคุณครับขอบคุณทาง Creative เชียงใหม่นะครับแล้วก็ก่อนจะเริ่มอธิบายมาแชร์ประสบการณ์ของโปรเจกต์นี้นะครับผมต้องขอขอบคุณทางคุณมาตินนะครับแล้วก็ทางดร.เกษมศักดิ์นะครับเพราะว่าก่อนที่เราจะเริ่มโครงการนี้เนี่ยเราได้ขึ้นมาเก็บข้อมูลกับทางCreative เชียงใหม่นะครับเพื่อที่จะหา best practice ที่เกิดขึ้นจากเชียงใหม่นำไปใช้ในโครงการ Co-create เจริญกรุงนะครับโครงการ Co-create เจริญกรุงเนี่ยเป็นโครงการที่เป็นการริเริ่มของหน่วยงานภาครัฐนะครับคือ TCDC นะครับ TCDC มีแผนที่จะย้ายจากศูนย์การค้า The Emporium นะครับไปอยู่ที่อาคารไปรษณีย์กลางบางรักซึ่งเป็นอาคารเก่านะครับซึ่งการย้ายไปนะครับทำให้มีแนวคิดที่จะพัฒนาย่านเจริญกรุงเป็น Creative District นะครับซึ่งจะทำให้ย่านเนี่ยนะครับมีการพัฒนาเศรษฐกิจนะครับไปเชื่อมโยงกับเรื่องของ Creative Economy นะครับการทำงานของโปรเจกต์นี้นะครับเป็นหน่วยงานภาครัฐ TCDC ที่ร่วมมือกับสสส.นะครับที่ให้ทุนสนับสนุนมาทำโครงการในพื้นที่นะครับแล้วก็พื้นที่ที่ทำงานจะเป็นพื้นที่ย่านเจริญกรุงครับด้านบนตรงนี้ก็เป็นย่านตลาดน้อยด้านล่างเป็นสาทรนะครับนี่คือพื้นที่เจริญกรุงพื้นที่เจริญกรุงเป็นพื้นที่สำคัญเพราะเป็นพื้นที่ประวัติศาสตร์นะครับพวกสถานกงสุลนะครับสถานทูตทั้งหลายเมื่อก่อนจะอยู่ที่ย่านเจริญกรุงทั้งหมดนะครับกระบวนการทำงานเราทำงานกันมาเป็นเวลา1ปีนะครับตั้งแต่กำหนดแนวคิดโครงการนะครับแล้วก็ที่สำคัญที่สุดก็คือการกำหนด stakeholders นะครับนั่นมีส่วนสำคัญมากในการทำกระบวนการนะครับเพราะว่าเราสามารถที่จะซับทราบข้อมูลจากกลุ่มที่ถูกต้องที่เป็นผู้มีส่วนได้ส่วนเสียในพื้นที่นะครับแล้วก็มีการระดมความคิดเห็นกิจกรรมนะครับตลอดระยะเวลาจนไปถึงช่วงท้ายที่เป็นการ test day ก็คือการทดลองทำพื้นที่จริงนะครับเราสร้างขึ้นมาจริงๆแล้วก็เก็บข้อมูลนะครับแล้วก็นำมาประมวลผลแล้วก็นำเสนอผลงานวิจัยที่เราต้องทำตรงนี้เพราะว่าเราต้องการที่ให้โมเดลนะครับแล้วก็กระบวนการเนี่ยสามารถที่จะนำไปใช้กับพื้นที่อื่นได้กระบวนการนี้ใช้ design thinking นะครับในการทำงานตลอดทั้งกระบวนการนะครับการทำงานนะครับจะมี3ทีมหลักก็คือทีม TCDC นะครับทีมจากธรรมศาสตร์ Design School ที่เป็นคนวางกรอบการศึกษาแล้วก็เป็นผู้เชี่ยวชาญนะครับแล้วก็อีกทีมหนึ่งที่ต้องพูดถึงคือทางอาจารย์ขวัญพงษ์หันยุทธนะครับซึ่งท่านมากับเราในวันนี้นะครับแล้วก็ทางบริษัทชมาโซเอนซึ่งเป็นผู้ทำกระบวนการแล้วก็ออกแบบพื้นที่นะครับร่วมกับคนในชุมชนนะครับการพัฒนาย่านสร้างสรรค์นะครับเชื่อมโยงกับการพัฒนาขีดความสามารถในการแข่งขันทางเศรษฐกิจของประเทศนะครับเพราะว่าพื้นที่เดี๋ยวนี้เวลาที่วัดขีดความสามารถในการแข่งขันก็วัดกันที่พื้นที่เมืองนะครับเชื่อมโยงไปถึงพื้นที่ย่านนะครับนั้นย่านสร้างสรรค์หรือว่า Creative District นะครับก็เป็นยุทธศาสตร์เป็นกลไกในการพัฒนาเศรษฐกิจของประเทศนะครับย่านสร้างสรรค์เป็นย่านที่เชื่อมโยงไม่ใช่แค่ความคิดศิลปะแต่ต้องเชื่อมโยงกับเศรษฐกิจของพื้นที่ด้วยนะครับนั่นสิ่งที่สำคัญก็คือจะมีพื้นที่เมืองนะครับมีแอสเซทนะครับสิ่งที่จับต้องได้จับต้องไม่ได้แล้วก็ creative class นะครับหรือ creative entrepreneur นี่คือ framework นะครับ research framework ของโครงการ co-create เจริญกรุงนะครับเราเน้นเรื่องของการสร้างพื้นที่ต้นแบบนะครับสร้างการมีส่วนร่วมนะครับใช้กระบวนการ design thinking แล้วก็มีการทำพื้นที่ต้นแบบนะครับทำกระบวนการมีส่วนร่วมนะครับในการออกแบบนะครับทำโฟกัสกรุ๊ปทำ participatory design workshop นะครับแล้วก็มีการทดสอบสร้างพื้นที่1ต่อ1นะครับตัวกระบวนการนะครับจะเริ่มนะครับตั้งแต่ต้นจนจบนะครับกำหนดกรอบแนวคิดไปจนถึงออกมาเป็นโมเดลในการพัฒนาพื้นที่สร้างสรรค์ซึ่งเราเชื่อว่าสามารถไปปรับใช้ได้กับทุกพื้นที่นะครับในทุกๆประเทศเราเริ่มจากการทำโฟกัสกรุ๊ปนะครับจากผู้มีส่วนได้ส่วนเสียทั้งหมด10ครั้งนะครับซึ่ง
การกำหนด identify stakeholder ตรงนี้มีส่วนสำคัญมากนะครับเราพบตั้งแต่คนที่เป็นครีเอทีฟในพื้นที่เยาวชนนะครับนักเรียนแล้วก็ผู้นำชุมชนนะครับหลังจากนั้นเรามีกิจกรรมกระตุ้นพื้นที่สร้างสรรค์นะครับที่ทำทั้งหมด7ครั้งนะครับโดยใช้แผนที่นะครับแล้วก็กระบวนการ design thinking ให้ทุกคนมามีส่วนร่วมในการแชร์ความคิดแชร์ไอเดียนะครับจนออกมาเป็นประเด็นนะครับที่สำคัญเราย่อว่า point นะครับก็มาจาก problem คือปัญหานะครับโอกาส opportunities นะครับ insight แล้วก็ need นะครับแล้วก็ออกมาเป็นธีม3ธีมก็คือ revival relink แล้วก็ rebrand นะครับจนออกมาเป็น4โครงการที่เป็นโครงการที่เราพัฒนาต่อนะครับแล้วก็นำโครงการนี้นะครับไปทำแบบรายละเอียดนะครับเพื่อระดมความคิดเห็นอ
าจารย์ครับเดี๋ยวขอเบรกแป๊บนึงนะครับเดี๋ยวผม let me summarize a little bit in English so that and then you can think about let me I want to see the slide so this project is the move of the TCDC to the new office which is the old postal office in Bangkok and it's the Jalan Krung area which is a historic part of Bangkok but it's actually been in terms of economic activity and everything social inclusion not being doing so well so the idea is that through the move of TCDC is also to kind of uplift the whole area and he's talking about the methodology and the community engagement to get the community participate and then identify four projects to drive through the change and begin that process
ขอโทษครับโอเคครับสำหรับกระบวนการ co-create นะครับคนที่เป็นคนทำงานส่วนใหญ่เนี่ยจะเป็นดีไซเนอร์นะครับดีไซเนอร์จะต้องเปลี่ยนบทบาทตัวเองจากดีไซเนอร์เป็นฟาซิลิเทเตอร์นะครับซึ่งตรงนี้เป็นเรื่องที่ยากมากเพราะว่าเราต้องการให้ทุกคนเนี่ยมีส่วนร่วมในการทำงานนะครับเราทำดีไซน์ออกมานะครับร่วมกับชุมชนแล้วเราก็มีกิจกรรมที่ทำให้ทุกคนเนี่ยมีโอกาสได้โหวตได้เลือกดีไซน์ที่เขามีส่วนในการทำขึ้นมานะครับนะครับก็มีการโหวตกันนะครับจากทุกคนในชุมชนมาทำออกเสียงร่วมกันนะครับจนได้ข้อสรุปเป็น4โครงการพื้นที่นะครับแล้วก็ให้ทุกคนมามีส่วนในการออกแบบนะครับมีส่วนในการออกแบบสิ่งที่เราคิดกันมากเลยก็คือใช้เครื่องมืออะไรนะครับที่ทำให้ทุกคนที่เป็นดีไซเนอร์และไม่ได้เป็นดีไซเนอร์เนี่ยมีความเท่ากันทั้งเด็กและผู้ใหญ่นะครับการใช้ดินน้ำมันก็ทำให้ทุกคนมีความรู้สึกเท่ากันนะครับสามารถที่จะมีส่วนในการออกแบบได้นะครับหลังจากนั้นมีกิจกรรมประเมินนะครับความคิดเห็นเกี่ยวกับตัวแบบที่ทำขึ้นมานะครับจนสุดท้ายไปทำเป็นการก่อสร้างจริงนะครับทั้งหมด5โครงการนำร่องนะครับอันแรกคือพัฒนาพื้นที่ริมน้ำนะครับก็สุดท้ายนะครับออกมาเป็นพื้นที่ที่ไว้จัดกิจกรรมหลักของงานนี้นะครับอีกอันคือพัฒนาอาคารที่ไม่ได้ใช้ประโยชน์เราพบว่าในย่านเนี่ยมีอาคารที่ไม่ใช้ประโยชน์ร้อยกว่าห้องนะครับก็ถูกนำมาปรับใช้นะครับเป็นโปรแกรมที่ทำงานเพื่อเยาวชนนะครับเพื่อชุมชนมีแอคทิวิตี้ที่รันตลอดทั้ง3วันนะครับพื้นที่สีเขียวขนาดเล็กด้านหน้าอาคารไปรษณีย์กลางบางรักก็มีการทดลองนำต้นไม้กลับมานะครับแล้วก็ปรากฏว่ามีคนไปสนใจแล้วก็ใช้พื้นที่เป็นจำนวนมากนะครับอีกอันก็คือการออกแบบป้ายสัญลักษณ์ในพื้นที่นะครับที่ทำให้ย่านเนี่ยสามารถที่จะคนเดินทางในย่านแล้วเดินทางไปได้นะครับการทำให้ขอบเขตต่างๆมันเชื่อมกันได้ง่ายขึ้นนะครับสุดท้ายเนี่ยเราได้เป็นเหมือนกับเจริญกรุงโมเดลที่ทำให้ทุกคนเห็นว่าการที่ทำพื้นที่สร้างสรรค์นะครับทุกคนสามารถที่จะทำได้ทุกคนสามารถเป็นผู้ที่จะริเริ่มทำได้นะครับแล้วออกมาเป็นโมเดลการออกแบบอย่างมีส่วนร่วมที่สามารถไปปรับใช้ได้กับทุกที่นะครับเดี๋ยวขอทุกท่านรับชมวิดีโอนะครับประมาณ3นาที
This area of Bangkok is a destination for leisure, for local people to come and relax, and also for tourism, international tourism.
อยากให้อนุรักษ์ไว้มากกว่าเดิมๆอย่างเงี้ยคือเราจะเห็นตึกเก่าๆจะเห็นอะไรที่มันภาพเก่าๆจะรู้ว่าเอ้ยนี่นะยุคสมัยก่อนที่เรายังอยู่อยากว่าให้มีคาเฟ่แมวจะดีสุดอยากจะมีที่ไปออกกำลังกายแบบไม่ต้องไกลไม่ต้องไปถึงสวนลุมเพราะว่าคนเจริญกรุงส่วนใหญ่จะไปออกกำลังกายสวนลุมเลยใช่ไหมคะซึ่งมันไกลออกไปอยากมีสวนสาธารณะ
การนำเรื่องของความคิดสร้างสรรค์ไปพัฒนาหรือฟื้นฟูเมืองถือว่าเป็นอีกหนึ่งบทบาทแล้วก็ภารกิจสำคัญที่ครีซีกำลังจะทำต่อไปในอนาคตนะคะ เราต้องทำงานร่วมกันกับผู้เชี่ยวชาญหลากหลายสาขาแล้วก็ดึงเอาส่วนผสมที่ดีที่สุดของทุกคนเนี่ยมาร่วมกัน
หมดปัญหาที่เราคิดว่า
ใช่ผมว่าในเสื้อรถได้เพียงพอกับฐานลูกศิษย์แต่ลงกันได
้ไม่มีที่แล้วต้องใช้เครื่องสีสายนี้ใช่ไหม
เก็บขยะค่ะน่าจะเก็บได้ติดตั้ง
TCC เองจริงๆแล้วเราชวนทุกคนมาร่วมกันค้นหาศักยภาพของย่าจันกุลที่ยังอาจจะซ่อนอยู่อาจจะยังมองไม่เห็นเราสร้างคำถามนี้ขึ้นมาแล้วเราก็ชวนทุกคนนะคะมาร่วมค้นหาโอกาสของย่าด้วยกันโดยมีวัตถุประสงค์เป้าเดียวกันค่ะคือการพัฒนาพื้นที่สร้างสรรค์เจริญกรุงให้เป็นพื้นที่สร้างสรรค์ต้นแบบของประเทศไทยค่ะ
Areas of the city, but the identity is not so clear yet. And sometimes, as like we talk about the Niemann area, it's been destroying itself a little bit. And also sometimes maybe the community working together. Dan Boon told me about another city where somebody opened a shop that didn't fit in with the environment at all, and nobody.And the people there in that city took action. There's no legal basis for it. But if people, if your neighbors walk to you and say, this is really not so okay with us, you know, can you think about how you design your shop? And so I think, you know, we need to be more aware of how we build our neighborhoods and then engage with city government. But in Chiang Mai, this is sometimes a little bit even more complicated than in Bangkok, maybe working with different levels of local government.ค่อนข้างจะซับซ้อนในจังหวัดเชียงใหม่ก็จะมีหลายเลเยอร์ของรัฐบาลในท้องถิ่นแต่ว่าเราก็ยังไงก็เป็นเมื่อวานมีคนบอกว่ายังไงเราก็ต้องทำงานกับเขาเพราะว่าเป็นรัฐบาลของเราก็เราก็ต้องก็คงจะเป็นแค่ private sector อย่างเดียวก็ไม่เวิร์กเหมือนกันก็ต้องเป็นร่วมมือกันนะครับก็ขอบคุณทั้งสองท่านนะครับแล้วก็จะอยู่กับเราถึงเย็นเราก็ดินเนอร์ด้วยใช่ไหมครับถ้าเป็นไปได้ก็อาจจะมีการแลกเปลี่ยนกันต่อนะครับจะสะดวกนะครับก็ขอบคุณนะครับขอเชิญตบมือนิดนึงครับ Thank you for the two speakers
มาตินเราจะมีแจกรางวัลกันไหมคะหรือว่า
ตอนนี้สัก5นาทีว่ายังไงเชิญคนมาแบ่งปันว่าเจอใครบ้างใช่ไหมครับเดี๋ยวเราอาจจะ that was a little improvisation but just to shake us up a bit and get you scared about who might get a question or be asked to do something right now we come to the last session right
ใช่ค่ะเวลาผ่านไปรวดเร็วมากเลยนะคะตอนนี้ก็เป็นช่วงสุดท้ายแล้วสำหรับงานวันนี้นะคะก็เดี๋ยวเราขอเชิญสำหรับในช่วงสุดท้ายนี้นะคะจะเป็นวิทยากรจากเอเชียตะวันออกเฉียงใต้นะคะทั้งหมด3ท่านมาร่วมบรรยายด้วยกันนะคะก็ ขอเชิญคุณโจซิแดกผู้จัดตั้ง George Town Festival คุณแจ็คลีนฟองผู้ร่วมก่อตั้งแบรนด์ Tanoti คุณอาจีซันติก้าผู้ร่วมก่อตั้งโคเวิร์กิ่ง Space บันดุงค่ะ Now we have our last panel with representative from Southeast Asia Creative City Next.
Thank you very much, Ban, for introducing our speakers for this last session. Joe has been here before. Last time he was the first speaker at the TEDx Chiang Mai event. He doesn't actually like to do public speaking. And so we said, okay, well, why don't you go first then at the whole event in front of 1,000 people. So, and Joe did that. And his talk is online. So Joe is the founder of the George Town Festival and had a huge impact on the community. And Jackie and I, we met, where was it? In Berlin? In Berlin, actually, where similar forum like this, Jackie and I got together. She was about to leave investment banking to focus more on her craft business, but today you will focus a bit more on another project, right? And then Aji, first time. Welcome to Chiang Mai. And Bandung is really interesting because as we learn about these cities in Southeast Asia, we find more things that we can learn from each other. And not everything is the same, but Chiang Mai also has a lot of history. It has craft, it has got design, and it wants to be a smart city. And we look at it, and Bandung is one of the coolest sort of smart city projects. Even got awards and so for the Bandung Smart City Development and a digital cluster, like Chiang Mai has a digital cluster. So we wanted to invite Aji. Right, so I'm taking a little bit more time since this is the last panel, but we are running behind. So let's start with Joe, and you will talk about George Town Festival, but from a new aspect, I think.
Thank you, Martin. I'm really pleased I'm here, and Jackie asked for this, and it's all great that I can hide behind this. It's really nerve-wracking. I come from the city of Georgetown in 2010, and getting the community to be involved, and also making arts very, very accessible. Some of the big shows that you'll see, the tickets are priced at $7 to have an access to some of the biggest shows. So that's the festival. We are in our seventh year. We move on to the eighth next year. was a recent festival. That was our first 5 years. We did something very brave this year. The 2016 is not there. We built a paddy field right in the middle of the city. I thought that was the sexiest thing that we've ever done in the last 7 years. But one of the key things that make the festival work is that we have a non-interfering government. We have total freedom in curation. The government supports us, the mayor supports us, the people support us, and the state government does not interfere in programming. So quite unlike the rest of Malaysia. And why we had to have a survey and figures, it's because at the end of the day, for a festival to be sustainable, we had to prove figures that it works, and so many million people saw it. We have about 250,000 visitors. Our website averaged, I think it was 12 million last year. And then after the festival, phenomena was that we're managing 600,000 hits a month after the festival. So there's a lot of storytelling. And so I'm now devising
Joe, can I just ask you a quick question? So the government funds some of the festival?
The government funds about 4 million of the festival, which is about 2/3 of the festival.
And they don't ask about the programming?
No.
They don't interfere?
No, no. I'm a Muslim. I've done sacred music
just,
in church.
Just top two and come kid Nina have Lataban Hangan. ทำเฟสติวัลขนาดนี้ที่เป็นอยู่ในนิวยอร์กไทมส์อะไรเงี้ย but ไม่ถามว่าต้องแต่โปรแกรมมิ่งเป็นยังไง
We had a show last year called Rimini Protocol 100% where I think it went to Yogyakarta after that where the people went up on stage and said reflected questions on corruption, religion, same-sex marriages and all that just quickly this is some of the press that we've hadAnd this is important for most festivals because this is where your sponsors come in and say, hey, you've got a lot of mileage, you've got a lot of international coverage. Our first 7 years was to build a name. The next 7 years I'll share with you is an ASEAN journey. What is important in a festival is that you're not alone. You're a part of a big picture where you need state government, you need mayors, you need Think City, you need people, you need programmers. It's not about the festival. It's about everything that makes the festival special.So because since 2010, Penang has won a lot of global accolades because it's, the system works, because all the agencies, like pieces of jigsaw, work together to make the city a really interesting, livable city. A lot of art spaces have come up because of, I wouldn't say because of the festival, but because Ernest, when he did the mural, suddenly every young artist from all over the world comes and stays in Penang for 2 years to paint more murals and do projects.So a lot of art spaces come out. Another result of this is the state government has decided to do a Penang Arts District. I would really like here to invite Cebu, Hanoi, and Bandung to come and advise us how it should be done the way you've done it, in a very organic way, and instead of top heavy, spend a lot of money and not knowing how to contend it. This is some of the art pieces that we have like hundreds all over the city.These are some of the new spaces that have come up in the last 5-6 years. Some of the projects I'm working on is storytelling. Georgetown is a sister city of Adelaide. We share the same founder. Francis Light founded Penang, William Light founded Adelaide. So one of the projects I'm commissioning for next year is called Connecting the Lights. This is the ASEAN Puppet Exchange because I'm working on a really big project for 2018-19 called Kulit, which is based on the shadow puppetry of Southeast Asia. I've invited Sidi Labi, a very well-known choreographer, to come and work with us so that it's an easy project to sell. So even though I try to think that I'm an artist, but I'm probably more of a businessman. So we're studying all the puppetries in the region. We have a very strong ASEAN focus because next year ASEAN is 50 years old.And the focus for ASEAN, I'm told by the ASEAN Foundation, is food. So I'm working on something called Laksa of the Region. And another project I would like to work on is creative design. I was very fortunate to sit next to the guy who started the London Design Festival. So I asked him, I said, would you consider collaborating with Georgetown Festival and ASEAN? So I would really like to reach out and whether we can work as a collective to send the best of ASEAN designs to London. And then after that, 2019, I have an idea of bringing ASEAN to New York. So if anybody has got any proposals or want to contact me, there's these forms out there that say, send us your proposal or contact me. I really feel 600 million people in ASEAN makes us a really, really strong force. And I think we have enough talents here to bring to London or New York. Have I finished? 1 minute, okay, last one.
2 minutes.
When I was at the ASEAN conference in Jakarta, I mooted an idea that if we brought a whole collection of collective of ASEAN, thinking Api Chapong, a filmmaker, Riti Pan, who's won major awards and an Oscar nomination, from Cebu, who's the designer from Cebu? Monique Hulier, and Kabakon, Kenneth Kabumpo. Right, so we have a lot of really big ASEAN names that my first project was to pull together all these big names, bring to New York, and subsequent years bring the second tier up and coming names. So if anybody can help me, please send me all the best names that you know in Southeast Asia, and let's work together. Thank you.
Thank you so much. So Joe has shared with us the impact that the Georgetown Festival had on Penang. It's really changed a lot in the last, maybe other factors too, but the Georgetown Festival has been a key driver in changing the city, making it hip, making it interesting. And one thing about the Southeast Asian Creative City Network that I haven't mentioned about is we focus a little bit more on second cities. You notice Kuching, Penang, Bandung, Cebu. We invite Bangkok as well. We have people from KL maybe and Manila. But all the cities that are core to the Southeast Asian Creative City Network are the second cities. Khon Kaen, also not the capital of Thailand. But we can learn from each other, and we can share, and we can cooperate. And of course, sometimes the capital may learn from us too. So this has really been the focus. But one thing is that sometimes we compete with the capital, and Penang, people move from Penang to KL. But through things like the Georgetown Festival, people are now moving into Penang, people feeling that there are job opportunities for them, for young people, for students, for artists and other professions. And I think what you're going to talk about is a similar sort of thing, is to create opportunities through space and creativity. Ti Kun Joe, the thing that Kun Joe is reaching out today is not about the Georgetown Festival, although that is one of the, you know, I always promote Chiang Mai, but for the beginning of August or whole of August, I have to also promote Penang and Georgetown Festival. You really have to go if you haven't been to. But that wasn't his point. His point was there's an opportunity now through him and through others involved to connect ASEAN with London, with New York, and reach out and create connections amongst ourselves too. So he's really going to make that happen. So if you have some idea, go to talk to him, right? Okay, next is Jackie, I think, from, yes, Jackie. Please, Jackie, tell us about a project that you've been involved initiating in your city of Kuching.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. This is the first page of my slide. I come from Kuching in Malaysian Borneo. I was born there, I grew up there, I spent the most formative years of my life there, and then I lived abroad, and until last year, I've been living abroad, but I returned. And why did I return? Because Kuching is my home, and Kuching is my identity, and I identify myself with it. But this is not my story. This is the story of my home. My home is defined by its incredibly rich history, its incredible diversity of people. We have 7 ethnic groups and more than 40 sub-ethnic groups, each with their own motives. Designs, architecture, textiles, costumes. Oh, so fast. Okay, textiles, costumes, jewelry, headgear, music, dance, stories, and of course our incredible nature, our landscapes, our flora and our fauna. In Sarawak, there is pride in its people. We are proud of where we come from, and we are proud of who we are. No pressure to redefine ourselves, no need, in fact, to strive to be what we are not. We are blessed to be identified by our own melting pot of indigenous, creativity. So the theory is that people are loyal to what they identify themselves with, culturally, emotionally, and spiritually. Taking this premise further, this type of identity will result in cohesiveness of group. Families will become closer, schools will become perform better, employees will stay longer, work harder, people will come and visit, customers will continue to patronize. Now this is also the story of our people and our craft. So let's now talk about our craft. Beautiful Malaysian craftsmanship from the days of old. We have the wayang kulit from what Joe was saying. Intricate songket, bright batik, the colourful wow, beautiful beadwork, metalwork, gasing, our spinning tops, our okiran. And many have become family heirlooms, and some make it into museums, hotels, building lobbies and galleries. All proud presentation of our country and its people. Unfortunately, in my country, too much of our exquisite craft are already antique. There is nothing new. During our country's quest for industrialization, over half a century, there is focus on building our resources, manufacturing services, and handicraft, which was so strong initially in our people's way of life, have fallen by our wayside. Rapid economic growth saw parents encouraging their kids to do well academically, new generations participating in the growing workforce of the country. Commercialization saw consumer products being produced by machines and undergoing highly complex supply chains. The digital age prevented craft from being pursued even further. Craft was lost for many, many generations. Suppliers dwindled in number, and consumer generation yearned for products of technology, comfort, and convenience. It was 5 years ago when I chanced upon the idea of investing in craft. There was a songket weaving workshop in my hometown about to be dissolved. It was owned by the former Queen of Malaysia, and funding was discontinued when Her Royal Highness was no longer Queen, and the foundation lost the mandate to fund an operations beyond her jurisdiction. My partner and I took it over almost overnight. We felt that it was critical to ensure that this heritage craft does not fall to neglect. We wanted songket to survive, and we wanted the skills to be practiced and proliferate to endure through time. We called it tanoti. It's a Sanskrit word meaning entwine or weave, and we pay homage to our Hindu origins of songket as a textile. Our tagline is putting the soul back into the fabric of society, because that is exactly what we wanted to do. We wanted our society to be cohesive because of its culture, our heritage, traditions and stories that come with handcrafted products. And we wanted songket to transcend eras and survive many, many more generations. Tanoti commenced our operations in May of 2012. It's been almost 5 years. Almost 5 years, we have grown an artisan community and trained more than 50 girls, won numerous awards, both internationally and locally, for our craft and our songket entrepreneurship. We have won 2 World Craft Council Awards for our work in songket. It was actually a very big feat for us. What we do is groundbreaking every day. We invest our resources into innovation and produce songket like songket was never before. Songket becomes trendy, cutting edge, and relevant. From traditional yarns such as cottons and silk, we have applied this technique to all sorts of different fibers, songket paper, songket leather, as you can see. Soon, fiber optic filaments and alloys. Our imagination will know no limits. Our limits are only in our time and our resources. Our business is set up to institutionalize the cottage industry. Only with proper system, organizational structure, and corporate ethos, this stage can be set to launch a craft renaissance. And this is our tanoti 3 years ago. I think we have much more staff now. But it cannot possibly stop there. Our vision is always to catalyze an entire ecosystem of creatives. Our vision is that we, as a nation, become a collective of individuals who are proud of what we do and the identities that we represent. So we started a project, and it's called Borneo 744. In February this year, we managed to secure a lease of a 10-acre site for setting up a creative entrepreneurship hub. It's a collaboration between three agencies, two private sector and one government, to see a center for a wide spectrum of arts, including visual arts, performing arts, fine arts, fashion, film, photography, and of course, craft. From the Malaysian Prime Minister's announcement in April 2016, Borneo 744 shall be Malaysia's first Blue Ocean Entrepreneurship Township. It's funded by the Malaysian Ministry of Finance, and we at Tanotia, we are very excited to be catalysts for this project. With Sarawak's huge, diverse cultural heritage, this is a natural mine for creativity. We hope that talents will arise and Borneo 744 will succeed into turning passion into profession. We want talents to be exploited, our creative assets to generate income, and when more join the fray, the possibilities and the outreach of a creative sector in my area are incredible, especially when the base is so small. We do not have a forum or a network that currently exists in places like Penang or Bandung or Cebu, and we believe that this could catalyze so into an ecosystem. We want our message to spread through all sorts of art forms, and we want our national pride to be reignited. And the end game is that we would like to have an economy of creativity that actually contributes to the national GDP. In the undeveloped world of creativity here in Malaysia, everything is a pioneering effort. It is not easy, and it takes a lot of heart to propel the willpower and determination to reach the tipping point. But this is what we have. And this is the site now. Actually, I'm in the middle of this picture. So it is a blessing that we have support from the Malaysian government, from our colleagues, from our associates, to make this project happen. The beginnings of Borneo 744 is from this site. We will anchor this space with 2,000 square meters with textile handcrafting. We are scheduled to move into our premises in the second quarter 2017, and we will open our doors to the public after that. Please watch this space. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jackie.
นโยบายและพัฒนา TCDC Thailand Creative and Design Center ค่ะ Our next session is about co-create artistic, and our two guest speaker will cover a talk about a project in Bangkok and how to work with the community and governments. So the speaker are Assistant Professor Dr. Piradon Gaelai, Senior Advisor TCDC Lecturer Thammasat University, and Khun Monchini Yongmikun, Director Policy and Planning TCDC. Please welcome.
As you know, the TCDC in today's event to start to share with, give Ajahn Piradon the opportunity to share with you what they're doing in Bangkok so that you know who to talk to. And as I think you say, it's not just for Bangkok and Chiang Mai, it's also for other cities. Actually, the video felt a little bit like Bandung style, you know. I thought it was a bit similar in the Bandung feeling. So I know that Tita and also Khun Montini and you have met before. So, right. So we covered one aspect, which is the community engagement. Another, I think, very important aspect is about other stakeholder involvement, particularly on the policy side, to create something like a district and make something like this happen. How do you coordinate with policymakers? So we wanted to invite Khun Montini Lukuntik from TCDC to share with us a little bit. Taming at stakeholder than Nayubai, my high quam son of Sunun, room will die. Got your good thing, Nahakun Montani.
Kunaka, the Shirley C. Macha, การทำงานของ TC ในวันนี้ซึ่งก็โปรเจกต์ที่จะพูดถึงก็คือโคเครียเจริญกรุงในฐานะที่ TC เป็นหน่วยงานของรัฐนะคะก็จะต้องเริ่มจากตัว policy ก่อน policy ใหญ่ก่อนก็คือ TC เนี่ยทำงานร่วมกับสำนักงานคณะกรรมการเศรษฐกิจและสังคมแห่งชาตินะคะตั้งแต่แผนที่11ในการทำแผนพัฒนาเศรษฐกิจและสังคมแห่งชาติเนี่ยตั้งแต่เมื่อประมาณเกือบ 7-8 ปีก่อนนะคะเพื่อผลักดันให้การพัฒนาประเทศเนี่ยมุ่งไปสู่ Creative Economy ดังนั้นเนี่ยในแผนพัฒนาที่11และ12เนี่ยก็จะมีเรื่องเกี่ยวกับการพัฒนาเศรษฐกิจบนพื้นฐานความคิดสร้างสรรค์หรือ Creative Economy เกิดขึ้นและในปัจจุบันรัฐบาลได้ทำแผน20ปีเนี่ยก็ได้บรรจุเรื่องนี้เข้าไปอยู่ในแผน20ปีของรัฐบาลด้วยทีนี้เรามาดูว่า Creative Economy เนี่ยหลักๆก็แบ่งออกเป็น2พาร์ทก็คือพาร์ทแรกก็คือ Creative Entrepreneur กับตัวที่เรียกว่าเป็น Creative Ecology หรือว่าเป็น Creative City หรือ Creative District นะคะซึ่งจะเห็นว่าในช่วงที่ผ่านมาเนี่ยเรามีโปรแกรมในการพัฒนา Creative Entrepreneur เนี่ยเกิดขึ้นหลายอย่างหลายหน่วยงานเริ่มเข้าใจเริ่มมีมาตรการต่างๆเกิดขึ้นโดยเฉพาะช่วงหลังๆเนี่ยเรามีมาตรการทางด้านการเงินการคลังในการสนับสนุนให้เกิด Smart SME หรือ Smart หรือ Creative Entrepreneur เกิดขึ้นแต่ในด้าน Creative District หรือว่า Creative City เนี่ยมีอยู่บ้างแต่ว่ายังก็อาจจะยังไม่เกิดชัดเจนมากนักในแง่ของในที่กรุงเทพนะคะทั้ง TCC ในฐานะหน่วยงานที่เกี่ยวข้องเรื่องนี้ดังนั้นเนี่ยเราก็ขยายบทบาทจากการที่เราทำในเรื่องของการพัฒนาผู้ประกอบการเราก็เริ่มมาสู่ในแง่ของการพัฒนาในแง่ของย่านสร้างสรรค์ซึ่งในที่นี้ก็คือเจริญกรุงก็ย้อนกลับมาที่ว่าทำไมถึงเป็นเจริญกรุงเราลงมาดูตัว Creative District ที่จะเป็น driver ให้เกิด Creative District เกิดขึ้นทีนี้เราพบว่าตัวเจริญกรุงเนี่ยมี3 angle ที่เป็นทุนเดิมอยู่แล้วก็คือเขามีทางด้านวัฒนธรรมมีสถาปัตยกรรมมีประวัติศาสตร์มี Creative Cluster ที่เป็น Creative Cluster เดิมของเขาอยู่แล้วก็คือ Jewelry หรือว่าเป็นตลาดแอนทิคตลาด Art Market นะคะแล้วก็เขามีสิ่งที่เรียกว่า Affordable Living ราคาของพื้นที่เนี่ยยังไม่ได้สูงจนเกินไปนักนะคะก็ถ้าดูนะคะโลเคชั่นก็คืออยู่ที่ริมแม่น้ำแล้วก็ติดกับถนนที่เป็นการค้าใหญ่ๆของกรุงเทพนะคะแล้วก็มีชุมชนในแง่ของการเป็น melting pot ก็คือมีชุมชนคริสต์อิสลามมีทุกอย่างผสมผสานอยู่ในนั้นหมดนะคะในแง่ของความเป็นย่านเก่าแก่และที่สำคัญก็คือที่บอกว่าราคาของที่ดินย่านเจริญกรุงนะคะถ้าเราดูปีล่าสุดก็คือปี2559ถึง2562เนี่ยสีลมเนี่ยที่ติดอยู่กับขั้นห่างจากเจริญกรุงไปไม่เท่าไหร่เองราคาประเมินอยู่ที่1ล้านบาทต่อตารางวานะคะลองมาดู10อันดับยังไม่มีเจริญกรุงเจริญกรุงยังอยู่ถึงแม้ว่ามันจะแพงขึ้นแต่มันก็ยังอยู่ในเรนจ์ที่แบบพอจะน่าพอจะจ่ายไหวได้คิดว่านะคะ 200,000 ถึง 500,000 นะคะทีนี้เรามีทุนในมือและหลักๆ3ส่วนสิ่งที่ TC มองก็คือเราก็ต้องมาเติมในส่วนของที่เรียกว่า Incubation Facilities and Programs นะคะซึ่งในแง่นี้รัฐบาล TC เนี่ยเป็นหน่วยงานของรัฐเราก็ต้องดำเนินงานทำโครงการดำเนินการทำ proposal ต่างๆเพื่อให้เกิดการ move TC เข้าไปอยู่ในพื้นที่นี้นะคะรวมถึงเราก็พยายามที่จะเข้าไปเป็นส่วนหนึ่งของพื้นที่นี้เพื่อให้เกิดเป็น Creative Ecology ขึ้นมาดังนั้นเนี่ยTCC ก็เลยย้ายตัวเองเข้าไปอยู่ในเจริญกรุงซึ่งเราเลือกอาคารไปรษณีย์กลางนะคะซึ่งในอาคารนี้ค่ะเราก็จะมีโปรแกรมต่างๆมากมายที่เกี่ยวข้องกับการพัฒนาผู้ประกอบการซึ่งเราไม่ได้จำกัดอยู่แค่ในตัวอาคารเราแต่ว่าเราจะทำงานร่วมกับพื้นที่ในชุมชนรวมถึงพาร์ทเนอร์อื่นๆเพื่อให้เกิดการพัฒนาในย่านนี้เกิดขึ้นนะคะทีนี้เรามี1 2 3 4 5มีทุกด้านและสเต็ปต่อไปที่เรากำลังจะมูฟเข้าไปก็คือเราทำตัวนี้ค่ะ Strong Community Stakeholder Platform ซึ่งแน่นอนว่ามันเป็นส่วนสำคัญของการพัฒนาย่านสร้างสรรค์ดังนั้นสิ่งที่เราทำก็คือ Co-create เจริญกรุงซึ่งเมื่อกี้อาจารย์พีระดอนได้อธิบายไปแล้วนะคะว่ากระบวนการในการทำให้เกิด Stakeholder Platform เนี่ยเกิดขึ้นยังไงบ้างเพราะว่าเราได้โมเดลของการทำย่านขึ้นมา1อันนะคะที่เราจะสามารถไปปรับใช้ได้แล้วก็ผลจากการทำ research เนี่ยค่ะทางบริษัทชมาโซเองซึ่งเป็นพาร์ทเนอร์ของการทำโปรเจกต์นี้นะคะก็ได้ทำงานขึ้นมาชิ้นหนึ่งแล้วก็ส่งไปประกวดและล่าสุดเนี่ยค่ะเมื่อเดือนพฤศจิกาในการประชุม World Architect Festival ที่เบอร์ลินเราก็ได้รางวัลมานะคะเพราะว่ามันเป็นการ
โปรเจกต์ที่เบสออนของกระบวนการมีส่วนได้ส่วนเสียของคนในย่านจริงๆนะคะ
เดี๋ยวนะครับคุณติ๊กแป๊บนึง so one minute so คุณมอนเตนี is explaining the components for making the creative district happening and that there are some areas that already existed like cultural institutions and some creative activities like a jewelry sector and affordable living space also quite important and so some gap analysis then what things could the TCDC fill to drive incubation facility programs creative ecology and then also the stakeholder platform so to make sure that this list is being completed so different activities and also this project has been awarded a prize even though it is kind of still a bit unusual that as I was reading at least that this project got the prize at the architecture world meeting even though it's still a little bit more on the prototype rather than finished stage but people like it so much that this is a really good role model also for others around the world so I think also our partners from Southeast Asia maybe over dinner tonight we can share more together okay sure
แล้วก็เรามีสิ่งที่เกิดขึ้นเรามีตัวพื้นฐานเดิมคือมีไซต์ที่เป็นย่านเก่าแก่มีตัว TDC เข้าไปเป็นส่วนหนึ่งของ Creative Ecology แล้วเราก็มีแพลตฟอร์มสำหรับ stakeholder หรือ strong เพื่อ create ให้ community ได้มีส่วนร่วมในการพัฒนาย่านทีนี้เราเหลือในส่วน3อันหลักๆก็คือเราจะมีมาตรการหรือนโยบายของรัฐบาลยังไงในการที่จะรักษาหรือว่าขับเคลื่อนให้ย่านนั้นเป็นไปอย่างเจริญเติบโตไปได้ในแง่ของเศรษฐกิจแล้วก็คุณภาพชีวิตนะคะดังนั้นเนี่ยแน่นอนว่ามาตรการต่างๆก็ต้อง based on tax หรือว่าเป็นมาตรการทางการเงินต่างๆและรวมถึงแผนพัฒนาที่ทำให้หน่วยงานทุกหน่วยงานเนี่ยมองเห็นภาพร่วมกันนะคะในที่นี้เราก็เรียกมันว่าเป็น Economic Development Plan of the District เพราะว่าเราขับเคลื่อนโดยเป็นแผนพัฒนาทางด้านเศรษฐกิจก่อนเพื่อในการ convince ให้หน่วยงานต่างๆเนี่ยมองเห็นภาพของความเจริญเติบโตแล้วก็มีการลงทุนแล้วก็พัฒนาในย่านนี้และท้ายสุดเนี่ยค่ะสิ่งที่เกิดขึ้นก็คือจะเป็นผลที่ในแง่ของทางเศรษฐกิจและสังคมที่เกิดขึ้นกับคนในย่านแล้วก็จะสามารถที่จะไปขับเคลื่อนในย่านอื่นๆต่อไปนะคะทีนี้ในการที่ทำให้3สิ่งเหล่านี้เกิดขึ้นเนี่ยอย่างที่บอกว่าเราเริ่มจากเรามองภาพใหญ่ก่อนว่าเรามองเป็นเศรษฐกิจสร้างสรรค์หรือ Creative Economy ซึ่งเรา define stakeholder ทั้งหมดเนี้ยออกมาให้เห็นว่ามันมีตั้งแต่ตัวอุตสาหกรรมสร้างสรรค์สถาบันการศึกษาหน่วยงานของรัฐที่เกี่ยวข้องทั้งหมดนะคะแล้วก็มีองค์กรการต่างประเทศรวมถึงหน่วยงานอื่นๆของภาคเอกชนนะคะที่จะ
I need a photo of this can somebody take a photo and post it online
แต่พอที่แต่ในแง่ของ Creative District นะคะเราก็ลองมาดูว่าเราจะต้องมี stakeholder อะไรที่เราต้องทำงานหลักๆบ้างนะคะแน่นอนเรายังต้องการอุตสาหกรรมสร้างสรรค์นะคะเรายังต้องการองค์กรการต่างประเทศต่างๆอย่างเช่นที่มารวมกันในที่นี้นะคะแล้วเราต้องการสถาบันการศึกษาเราต้องการที่สำคัญมากๆคือกรุงเทพมหานครค่ะก็คือ local government agency นะคะสำคัญที่สุดนะคะเพราะว่าเป็นคนที่มีอำนาจในการที่จะตัดสินใจแล้วก็พัฒนาเมืองนะคะแล้วก็เราต้องการกระทรวงการคลังเราต้องการ BOI ในแง่ของมาตรการทางภาษีต่างๆนะคะในการที่จะก่อให้เกิดการลงทุนและการพัฒนาต่างๆนะคะแล้วก็เราต้องการแลนด์ลอร์ดในที่พื้นที่เจริญกรุงที่เข้าใจนะคะทั้งภาครัฐและเอกชนนะคะดังนั้นกลุ่มนี้นะคะก็จะต้องมาทำงานร่วมกันซึ่งจากแพลตฟอร์มนี้นะคะก็คือจากเบื้องต้นเนี่ย เราได้ Creative District Platform แล้วจากกระบวนการวิจัยแล้วก็กระบวนการที่ทางอาจารย์พรีดอนได้ทำมานะคะเราก็ได้โปรโตไทป์มาแล้วเราได้โปรโตไทป์ที่จะต้องทำก็คือเป็นเกิดจากการที่คนในย่านต้องการจริงๆนะคะเสร็จต่อไปก็คือเราก็จะทำไพลอตโปรเจกต์พวกนี้ค่ะเพื่อให้เกิดตัวโปรเจกต์ขึ้นมาจริงๆยกตัวอย่างเช่นเราจะทำโปรโมชั่นอีเวนต์เราจะทำเอาพื้นที่ต่างๆเนี่ยมาทำเป็นดีไซน์เรสซิเดนซีหรืออะไรก็แล้วแต่ท้ายสุดเนี่ยเราก็จะได้โจทย์อะค่ะไปคุยกับ government agency เพื่อว่าให้เกิดกระบวนการคือกระบวนคำว่า project workshop เนี่ยอาจจะไม่ได้หมายถึงว่าจับ government agency ทุกคนมานั่งอยู่ในห้อง workshop ให้ได้ผลออกมาแต่มันคือกระบวนการทำงานร่วมกันดังนั้นเนี่ยสาเหตุที่เราทำเป็น project ขึ้นมาเพราะว่าท้ายสุดแล้วเนี่ยในการใช้พื้นที่ก็ดีเราก็ต้องไปทำงานร่วมกับทาง government agency อยู่ดีนะคะและท้ายสุดกระบวนการเหล่านี้ค่ะก็ต้องทำ
กลับไปกลับไปกลับมากลับไปกลับมาจนกระทั่งเราคาดว่านะคะในปี2018เราน่าจะได้ตัวมาตรการหรือว่ารวมถึงตัวมาสเตอร์แพลนของการพัฒนาพื้นที่ย่านสร้างสรรค์ออกมานะคะเพื่อว่ามันจะได้เป็นจุดในการคิกออฟในการพัฒนาย่านสร้างสรรค์ที่มันเป็นรูปธรรมชัดเจนมากยิ่งขึ้นนะคะขอบคุณค่ะ
Thank you very much สงสัยต้องยืนไมค์ก่อน Have you met somebody at this event and you would like to or you got some idea you wanted to just express maybe you would like to share something
I'll introduce myself first. I'm Anusha. This is my first time in Thailand and in Chiang Mai. We just came to attend the Design Week. I have met a few people, but I have a question related to somebody from the university who was presenting in the morning, a big building that's supposed to have a lot of working spaces, entrepreneurship spaces. As well. It was a science and tech park, I think. Yeah. So my question really was, are there as many people setting up businesses in Chiang Mai? Because I do not have any context of that. Like, is there an opportunity for such a huge space to actually be used and be sustainable in itself?
Okay.
Yeah, that was my question.
Right, okay. So this is how it works. You can share your ideas. You can tell about a friend you met. And we will go from table to table. So if you would like to get a free shirt or a book, raise your hand as Ban and I move from table to table so you can get one of these prizes. So the question here about was about the Science and Technology Park. Just to give a quick answer, it's not only for startups, it's also to support existing companies and industries in Chiang Mai. So they will work with both startups and existing companies in Chiang Mai. And we'd like to see more startups. Thailand is pushing a lot for new startups. But it's not only for them, but certainly space for them too. Okay? So,
thank you so much.
And she gets a free shirt. Yes.
Okay. Anybody else want to share with us?
Kai Bang, you must have a British Council team here, I think. Can somebody from you? Come on, Jay. Okay. Something new, interesting, surprising.
Okay. No, we both had. Well, I had a twin, and he has a twin. we both. Well, I had a twin, and he has a twin, and that's just a newfound fact. I didn't realize that before, and we've been working together for years and years.
Okay. เขาก็มาจาก British Council ด้วยกันนะครับแต่เพิ่งเจอว่าทั้งคู่ก็มีแฝดนะครับเป็นฝาแฝดกันI mean, this sounds maybe banal, but you know, how do you create lasting relationships and new friendships is to little stories like this. So we will give her, you can choose what you like, so a shirt or something. There's somebody over there I would like to introduce anyway, because he's a dear friend and he hasn't had a chance to talk yet. Ayip. Hello, Ayip. Introduce yourself briefly. Who are you?
I'm a creative activist from Bali, Indonesia, and I also founding member of Southeast Asia Creative Cities Network. And now, I was invited to Chiang Mai Design Week, and I have exhibition at TCDC. I invite all of you to see the exhibition.
Thank you very much, Ayip. Sorry for surprising you as you were chatting away. But he gets everything for free anyway. But give him a shirt as a surprise. Thank you, Ayip, for. Me, Kai, I might have the Ben Ban story. Need to have just. I think I'm looking at two ladies here. Something to say? Something to share?
Hello. My name is Taz, and it's been a very interesting day. I met quite a few people. I just met PDD, she's a candidate, PhD candidate actually, and I met surprisingly Pete Jack, who is my Lun Pi from the faculty and from the marketing associate Thailand. And stuff. I met Pito, who went to church with me. I recently went to church like for 4 weeks now, and it's yeah. I have a question for Bandung speaker in the morning. Like she mentioned the situation about the green space that was about to like turn into the condos and building and stuff. So that reminds me of the situation in Chiang Mai that almost happened on like near the schools. And so I was just wondering about the, like she said she built the footpath, the path to walk, and that saved the space. So I was just wondering like how is that footpath help save the forest. Thank you.
Right, so Tita, do you mind coming over here and have a little chat with her and sit down on this chair that I just pulled over to help that answer that question? And please give both of them a shirt, please, both of them. Okay. Thank you. One more.
Mikhail,
ไหมครับที่จะไปเจอใครบ้างน่าสนใจหรือไอเดียหรือคำถามเป็นโอกาสคำถามถามเราก็ได้รางวัลนะครับ You get a prize for asking a question. How about that? Otherwise I come to you. From this table, we haven't really. How about okay.
I met four people. Everyone interacting, but two of them gone from me. Now only guest speaker still. They are from Johobalu and Jotau, I think, from Malaysia, Mr. Joe. And Fasa, right? The lady Malaysian. Mm. And interesting people who gone. She's a lady from Netherlands, Miss Andelina, who run the foundation, build up the dormitory and school for the Hugh Thai people in Mae Hong Son. They run a big fund, 85 million. Something like that. And one gentleman from New York, he is a New Yorker. He go to Chiang Mai every year, 4 months in a year. He here to participate the knowledge and share experience. And he curious to know what happened today. And for me, I get a lot of knowledge from different country in Southeast Asia. And from the participants. And my question is how we enforce or what about the implementation? Thank you.
Right. Thank you very much. Where's the prize? Okay. So how do we implement today?